Mr. Pop.
Sitting on my chest, without a place to call home. Without a ride by my side, without a place of our own.
Good evening, citizens of post-apocalyptia. This is your disc jockey after doomsday, DJ Pony. Well, I have to say, Ten Pony management has been quite a bit nicer since Duchess Rose has taken up residency here in the tower. We have a freshly remodeled lobby that now has a beautiful obsidian tiled floor. Not to mention the fountain in the middle has 20% less chips and cracks than it did before. Once it's fully patched, it will get a new water seal coating and look like a million caps. I guess you could say results matter, but the Duchess strutting her stuff up and down the hallways hasn't hurt either. If you ask me, that's a much better view than the gold-plated chandeliers. I'm going to pay for that joke.
Oh, you sure are.
It probably doesn't help that her suite is right down the hall, does it?
Well, maybe not for you, but it will for me, because I'll get to sip tea in the corner watching you get yelled at for talking about her ass on the radio.
As you Wastelanders can hear, my wonderful assistant Homage has been making guest appearances on the air lately, which believe me wasn't easy. She used to be terrified of the idea. You would have thought the microphone was a rad scorpion tail the way she used to look at it.
Well, sorry, but I'm new at this.
That is true. She's not used to being on the air. But for the past year or so, Homage has been a huge help behind the scenes on the production side of things.
Oh, you wouldn't believe how disorganized the music collection was. Okay, none of the holo tapes were alphabetized. There wasn't any kind of organization by artist or genre. All of the vinyl records were more or less in a big pile. He basically chose songs based on whichever album art looked prettiest that day.
Not always. If it turned out to be a drag, I would put it in a different huge pile. I'm not going to play the same dreary, terrible song over and over again for no good reason. You know what they say, you can't judge a book by its cover, but a record sleeve speaks volumes.
Was that a pun?
Kind of. But on top of bringing some order to the controlled chaos that is my life, Homage has also been a huge help getting some of my equipment refurbished and improved. Whether she likes it or not, the broadcasting studio is definitely where she belongs.
Well, some pony had to wire up the interrogation room with the right equipment.
Yes, indeed. It was very nice of the Ministry of Arcane Science to have left this behind for us. Not quite sure why they had one in the first place. This doesn't exactly seem like the best place to keep political prisoners. But when you're neurotic enough and the wartime paranoia is at its peak, you end up doing some crazy things. So now we have the perfect studio set up for interviews and music recording. The room was decently soundproofed, but we're having to borrow some of the panels for our next big project, getting the off-site broadcasting station set up. So you'll have to excuse some of the background noise. It wouldn't be necessary otherwise, but as nice as this place is, something tells me we'll have more interview guests down the road that won't quite conform to Ten Pony standards. But luckily, that is where our friend comes in, who also happens to be the next guest for Confessions of a Wasteland Pony. Welcome to the program, Miss Amber Horn.
Glad to be back.
So, what is the right word for that? A characternym, where your name literally describes who or what you are? Unless you'd like to claim that your horn is orange as opposed to amber.
No, that's definitely where my name comes from, which is lucky for me because otherwise I could have been named Banana Sweets or something dumb like that.
That wouldn't have been so bad. I like bananas anyway. So, how many times do you think you've been up here to DJ Pony Studios?
Every time you've blown a fuse or burned out a panel. So, I'd say a couple dozen.
Amberhorn is our youngest and arguably most talented of the engineers that work in Ten Pony Tower's generator room. When she took up residence in the tower, she quickly became one of our biggest fangirls. When I first met her, along with some compliments and accolades, she brought me a wealth of notes and comments on what I could do to improve the station. If I recall correctly, the number one comment was, "Play more Amoria music."
Yes, it was. But instead you ended up moving a relative of hers into the tower. That's not the same.
Well, don't give up just yet, because after some whining of my own, I was able to convince Duchess Rosepetal to help us track some down. I'm sure she'll help us find something soon enough.
She better.
Besides Amber's helpful suggestions, she has also done wonders around the studio. She came to my rescue when I somehow fried my distributor box and lost power to the whole suite. It was a crisis situation, because when I'm in the dark, all of you get left in the dark without a place to find cold, hard truth when you need it most.
And thanks to me, you don't have to run 3 servers out of the same outlet anymore.
No, I've learned my lesson. There's something humbling about using bottles of Sparkle Cola as emergency lanterns. Good thing those isotopes have a few thousand half-lives left in them. Thanks to these two, I've had a tag team of badly needed tech support to get things swinging at full tempo again. Alma arrived a few months after Amber, and they quickly became BFFs. If only you could see them eating fancy cheeses outside Monterey Jack's. They'll sit there giggling like schoolgirls while talking about circuitry and electronics. It is the most adorkable thing ever.
Hey!
Oh, alright. Moving on. Amber came to us a few weeks ago after hearing the horrifying tale of Duchess Rose, and mentioned that she'd also like to share her story. Now, I've heard bits and pieces, but Homage knows quite a bit more, and wanted to make sure you were comfortable with this beforehand.
You don't have to do this. We can still play a rerun if you want.
No, it's something I want to do. Because the story isn't just about me, but my family as well, so it might take a while.
That's all right with me. We've got all the time in the world. Plus, we can actually put some of my mixing board equipment to proper use. If you help cue Homage and I for when to work the dials, we'll give your retelling proper emphasis. Not only for the sake of the listeners, but to help do your family justice.
I appreciate it. They've done so much for me. Their story deserves to be told. And if it can help anyone, like Battered Blade's story, or Dr. Greenshift's, or even Rose Petals, then it's worth telling.
Okay, so, how far back do we begin?
Quite a ways, actually. With my dad.
Yes, I think most of us understand how that works. You were a twinkle in your father's eye and 32 chromosomes of love?
No. No. That's not what I meant. I mean, the story begins with my dad back when he was a kid. He grew up in a little village to the northwest. It didn't even have a name. It was just him, his parents, and a dozen other families that lived together.
What's your dad's name?
Sparky. It started out as a nickname, but his parents used it so often that he didn't remember what his full name was.
Sparky's a good name. I wouldn't mind it myself.
Of course, to me, he has always been Dad. It was always a bit weird when I heard people calling him by his name. He's a unicorn, like me, but a cayenne-coloured coat and a dark blue mane.
It is nice seeing ponies out there with brightly colored coats. They're like the few stars of vibrant life that stand out against the dreary browns and grays of the wasteland. So, where exactly is he from? You said northwest of here?
Yes, something like that. It's a place called the Five Highways, overall a relatively empty part of the wasteland. The region used to be a major industrial shipping route, so there weren't any big groupings or towns, just these 5 large highways that connected all the major pre-war manufacturing cities. Most of the old signs had been torn down for scrap metals, so the highways were just numbered 1 through 5, heading west. The settlers that lived out there had a small farm to grow just enough crops to keep them fed. Anything else they needed, they scavenged from the wrecked vehicles or the little towns scattered along the old freeways. By today's standards, they had a normal enough life. For a long time, the only thing they had to worry about were the occasional mutant creature attacks. My dad was a really happy kid at that point. His parents, well, my grandparents, were basically the stereotypical farmers. Like that famous equestrian Gothic painting. My grandfather would work in the fields and my grandmother would take of the household chores. It was a quiet, simple life. Like the time before the old kingdom was set up and everything became so metropolitan. It was their home and they loved it just the way it was. But, of course, a private wasteland hideaway like that couldn't last forever. No one has that kind of luck anymore. When my dad was 7 or 8, a new threat had entered the area. All these small scattered communities and the usefulness of the old highways had made the land perfect for slavers.
Oh, goddesses.
My dad was really playful and lively as a colt, so when he saw the group approaching from a distance, he went and told my grandparents enthusiastically, thinking that they were travellers to trade or move in. None of them had heard of slavers in that area before, so they weren't prepared. The caravans had several dozen slavers which circled the village and routed them up in the centre of the town one by one. They were mostly equipped with medium-sized weapons, some rifles and some machine guns, but there were two big enforcers who had mini-gun battle saddles. There was also one sniper who took position with an impressive scope. Once the town was herded together, this scrawny light grey buck walked forward between the two enforcers. He had a long, greasy black mane, and he was missing his front two teeth. He called himself Fast Whip. He tipped his black gaucho hat to the crowd. He announced to the townsfolk that they now belonged to him. While some of his goons walked out with neck and chest shackles, he told my father's villagers to put them on, or else.
Which I'm guessing is when someone followed up with, or else what?
Not exactly. My grandfather stepped forward, who I should remind you was a workhorse that ploughed the fields most of his life. Then, with all his might, he reared back and bucked one of the slavers in the face, instantly breaking his neck.
Kick ass! Good old-fashioned horseshoe diplomacy.
It was an admirable show of force. But even with the other larger stallions in the village, they were outgunned and outmatched. A few of the others tussled with the guards, but they were quickly beaten down. For starting the outburst, my grandfather had to pay a steep price. Other slavers tackled him and dragged him to the front by Fast Whip. After making some terrible speech about learning your place, he proceeded to flay my grandfather in front of my dad and his mother. He was literally whipped to death.
Ugh, damn slavers. You hear a lot about how scary and depraved raiders are, but if you ask me, slavers are worse.
I think so too, absolutely. Raiders are very different in the horrible shit they do. Like Battered Blade explained, raiders are almost like animals. Everything about them is so impulse and crazed. They're just violent for the sake of being violent. Slavers, on the other hand, aren't crazy per se. They're just straight up evil. They act like the normal, that their whole game is just business, and they pretend what they're doing isn't as fucking terrible as it is by justifying it. Saying that, slavery is just how the wasteland works, or it is for people to work off a debt. But that veneer falls away pretty quickly whenever a slave steps out of line and gets whipped for it. Most of the time, the slavers will keep them alive with meds and other things because ultimately, they want them to keep working. That's why they are worse than raiders. Raiders may torture or rape you for a few days, but you end up dead regardless. Slavers will physically and mentally torture you for your whole life, and they'll make that life last as long as they can, to squeeze every last bit of work out of you.
So, how did your father and grandmother respond to his death?
My grandmother totally broke down once the whipping had stopped. She threw herself onto his body while crying hysterically. They had never known that level of violence. The five highways are such a large and barren stretch of land that they had been fairly isolated up until that point. Fastwhip, the slave master, made one more example out of her. He walked up to her, pulled out a pistol, and shot her in the head. After that, the rest of the village fell into a shock silence. My dad was one of the youngest kids in the group, and he had just watched his parents be viciously murdered in front of his eyes. He barely spoke at all after that, for years. He only said anything when the slavers demanded it.
I don't even have the words to respond to such a tragedy.
Once the town was rounded up, they were brought to the main slave camp. The camp surrounded a small town next to one of the highway turnoffs. The building had been gutted and turned into warehouses. There were the areas the slavers worked and slept. The headquarters of the camp was where the slave masters stayed. It was a three-story motel called the Oasis. Fastwick probably chose it for the sick irony. My dad and his villagers walked through the main gate that faced the highway. The chains rattled around their legs as they were brought into the prison they would call their home. The next day, they were given their tasks. All the child slaves, like my dad, were basically sorters. The adults would bring in wagons full of things that they have scavenged from the wasteland that day. They would pour the junk into a big pile, and the children would sort through it all, put things in different areas based on their usefulness. The items they found were either kept, sold, or turned into something else. My dad was the kid that sorted a lot of the electronics they found. As time went on, he'd tinker around with the pieces to pass the time, and sometimes to get them working again. This continued on for a few years until the slavers noticed how good he was at fixing their old technology, so they tasked him with doing it full time. He was so good that the slave masters had him inside the main building often, fixing their computers and setting up networks and other machines. My dad considered it lucky because they started treating him better as he gained their trust. Plus, he thought that by showing them everything you could do with machines, it would take some of the spotlight off some of the other slaves to make their lives easier.
That's a great idea. Did it work out that way?
It did for a while. By getting the generators and other technology involved, it lessened the burden on the slavers by doing some of the harder, back-breaking jobs. For instance, my dad got a conveyor belt working again, which meant the slaves didn't have to carry those over-encumbered saddlebags back and forth from the scrap pile to the warehouse. With more machines, the slavers became tasked with more technical operation jobs that my dad would teach them. They went from the hard labour to replacing fuses, resetting the computers, and building logic tables and doing machine maintenance. The ones that weren't doing that were scrappers, going out and just finding old stuff for the kids to process or sort. There were still the manual labour-driven jobs, but my dad had just industrialised Fastwhip's whole operation, which made things better for the slaves and the slavers.
And they were learning a lot of science and repair skills in the process as well.
Absolutely. Based on consumer market, Fastwhip's slave operation was mainly about two things, drugs and guns. Most of what the scrappers found were broken and used to fix guns or hodgepodge together new ones. Some of the ideas they had were actually pretty creative. There was this one kind of weapon, which I have myself, called the stuff gun. It was built around these industrial air compressors that could launch anything from a fork to a dinner plate at over 100 miles per hour.
It turns cutlery into ammunition? Sounds like quite the food fight.
Yes, but the only problem was is that you had to reload after every shot. And it only had one pressure chamber, so anything that was loaded into the gun all got fired at once. It was sort of like a shotgun that would fire whatever you crammed inside of it.
Still pretty cool. You said the other thing they made was drugs?
Yep. Any chemicals, medical supplies, or cleaning agents got turned into some sort of dangerous drug for someone to snort or inject themselves with. A lot of it was a real waste too. They'd break down actual beneficial things like stims or Medex potions into terrible hard narcotics. So instead of benefiting from useful medicines, the chemical cocktails would end up killing you faster than you could enjoy the high. Most of the buyers were raiders or some kind of asshole, so none of them really cared that they were buying things made by slaves. They just wanted their guns and drugs. They were morons too. Before my dad came along, most of the machines making these chemicals and ammos were dangerously unstable. Fast Slip was losing one slave a month just trying to keep everything working. Then there was the ammunition itself. The tolerance and materials were so poorly designed that the ammo was just as dangerous to the user as it was to the threat. Many raiders were having their face blown off from the backfire of their own gun. But thanks to my dad, the process started turning out well-constructed ammo that offered improved accuracy along with a better chance of not killing its user. Even though that benefited raiders, enough of the clans fought each other that the amount of dead scumbags remained the same.
So now that the slaves were a bit better off thanks to your father, how long did things last like that?
About a decade, by the time my dad was 19 and had gained a great deal of freedom, at least as much as a slave could have. He would walk all over the Oasis slave camp to inspect the machines and talk to the others and see if there were any issues. He did all he could to keep the slaves working efficiently and keep all the machines running. He made sure the slaves ran everything like clockwork, so the slavers and guards wouldn't have to get involved at all. His philosophy was to give the slavers no reason to complain or mistreat any of the slaves by doing what he could to keep things operating smoothly. The hardest job he had was calming the newly captured slaves. I mean, just think about it. What you'd feel after watching your friends and family die than having to obey and work for the slave masters who killed them? Most of them got pushed to an emotional limit, so my dad had to be there as a rock to lean on to help them settle into circumstances.
So your dad would almost be like a therapist, which I'm guessing was especially hard because no one reacts to trauma in the same way.
You're right about that. There were mainly three different categories of slaves he had to help, with totally different ways to address them. The first kind were the criers. They were the ones who wept all hours of the day, who were totally depressed about the situation. My dad tried to pair them off on different machines with an older pony who had been there for a while. He thought that they would be able to gain their strength back seeing some pony who had survived and carried on. The second were the fighters. They were the ones that were always taking swings at the guards and getting lashed for it. My dad would try to reason with them. Don't give them satisfaction of whipping you. Keep it bottled up inside. One day, our time will come. I think deep down my dad always envied them. He wished he could lash out and tear Fast Whip and his slavers to pieces. But he had been beaten down for too long. He didn't have the strength or the courage to fight, and had settled on the idea of making their lives as easy as he could. He expected to die in that slave camp.
That's probably the saddest part of all, when the circumstances finally crush your spirit.
That was the problem with the third category. The ones who were a lot like him when he was captured, they would shut down and become almost zombie-like. Some of them would be okay. They would do whatever task was given to them and slowly come around. But the real tragedy were the ones who wouldn't. They were the ones that wouldn't do a thing. They wouldn't eat, they wouldn't drink. They would just sit there with the vacant expression in their eyes. It would have been long until they were declared useless and thrown into a deep pit outside of the camp. The old well had become a mass graveyard. Any time a slave died, they were thrown in there. Any slave that was deemed worthless would be thrown in alive and would eventually starve to death. The foul smell of dead bodies would linger around the edge of the camp as a constant reminder of what could happen.
Just a horrible, horrible tragedy. That's the kind of evil that makes the wasteland what it is, when things could have been so much better by now. So, you said that your dad was only 19, but he had this much interaction with all the other slaves?
It was all thanks to him that all the machines were running again, so Fastwhip was more than happy to let him handle the slaves as long as the products kept rolling off the assembly line. He had become the head slave of sorts, and was trusted enough to run the operation with a lot of autonomy. Unfortunately, my dad's innovations just made Fastwhip more powerful. Because everything ran so smoothly, Fastwhip devoted most of his time and many of his men to finding and capturing new slaves along the five highways. His operation was getting larger all the time. Seeing his plans work against him was starting to wear on my dad. He was feeling guilty for his role in things, and he was starting to consider what else he could do. At the same time, Fastwhip wanted to have a tighter control of all the slaves, so one night, he brought my dad into the Oasis Motel building. Fastwhip explained that he wanted him to build bomb collars, so that he could use them to control all the slaves remotely. My dad felt like he had reached a crossroad. There was no way he could build such a device, and he felt it would make him even worse than the slavers, so he had to think and come up with a answer he would hope would satisfy them. He said that the only radios that would work were the ones like found in pit books. He knew the unpopulated pre-war land of the five highways meant there shouldn't be any stables for hundreds of miles around.
Why is that?
Because they were mostly built near the big cities, so that citizens could get to them quickly before the bombs fell. Even before the war, there were barely any towns along the freeways. They were only meant to connect the far distant big cities together. The three dinky story Oasis Motel was probably the largest building for hundreds of miles. Fastwhip seemed to accept the answer and dismissed him. My dad thought that was the end of the issue until he summoned him once more a few weeks later. He was brought out to the front by the main gate, where 36 freshly captured slaves were standing, each of them wearing a pit book on the leg. Fastwhip began addressing them together.
Take a look at this lot of happy faces. They descended from stable dwellers themselves, and all of these beautiful little trinkets handed down to them from their ancestors. That includes a few more whose owners don't need them anymore.
He turned to the stable dwellers.
Which one of you knows these wrist computers the most?
He held up a bloody one that the slavers had given to him.
I do.
The mare at the front stepped forward. She was an earth pony with an aqua coat, a white mane with soft pink stripes, and bright purple eyes. Her name was Abalone, and she was the leader of their village. Her mark was a lavender energy crystal, like the kind you use to power arcane devices. But before she could say anything else, another mare stepped up and pushed her back. She was an orange-coloured unicorn with a soft yellow mane. Her mark was an image of a stable tech server with a notable green tint of its screen. Her name was Amberglow.
Your mother.
The first mare, Abalone, looked horrified, like Amberglow had just taken a place to be executed. But it was no use. Amberglow's mark gave her away too easily. It was obvious she was the one keeping the pit books running all these years, but Abalone was still hard-pressed to let her go. She loved her too much and was afraid to watch her little sister die.
Sister?
Yep, my aunt Abalone was in tears as she watched my mother walk forward.
I'm the engineer in our village.
Fast Whip approached her like a slithering snake.
That's good to hear. I'm going to need you to remove them pit books from your buddies. I'd have my men do it, but they aren't as careful. No sense losing a leg over it.
The bastard laughed and then motioned my dad.
You'll be helping, Sparky. Turn them into the most useful tools. Well, more useful to me anyway.
Fast Whip then walked off as the other slavers took them into the camp. My dad walked beside my mum.
I'm so sorry this happened to you, he said to her, his voice shaking with guilt. I told him I needed pit books to make his bomb collars. I had no idea any of you existed around here. Please, forgive me.
It's not your fault, she said back to him. It would have happened one way or another. If it weren't the slavers, it would have been something else. My dad was taken back a bit. My mum had certain weariness in her voice, like this had happened before and she was going through the motions. But before he could ask anything else, my mum had handed him a pit book key and started taking them off her villagers.
Those are pretty sad circumstances to meet each other. Hopefully their first date went better.
In a way. Once I had all the pit books, my dad took her to the corner of one of the warehouses that he used as a workshop. He had several terminals, tools and other equipment lying about so that he could use them to build anything. My mum seemed interested right away. She was marvelling at the collection he had put together. She talked about barely having any space in the small sheet metal cabins that she and her sister built in the village. Most of the town had been built out of metal frames from wagons, cars and a few airships. From there, my dad told her about how they stripped cars themselves, mainly focusing on the engine parks and the spark batteries. Both of them were basically self-taught engineering and scientific skills. And now they each had someone to relate to in all the strange things they encountered along the journeys. Like my mom miswired a heatsink and melted a terminal. Or that one time my dad used the wrong kind of metal to make a gear, so it blew apart inside the gearbox. Being enslaved was the last thing either of them wanted to talk about, so they ended up in an in-depth conversation about programming and technology. The one thing that has always brought them together. They could shut out the rest of the world and focus on whatever they were doing with their horns and hooves. They were never more alive than when they were building something together. That is how you could tell, even at the very beginning, that they were in love. They ended up working in the shop for hours into the night. My dad, despite his claim, had never seen a pit book before. So, together, they broke one down. And my mother was telling him about every piece. My dad had several stable tech terminals in his workstation that they compared it to. My aunt Abalone said that they both told her about the first night with the same radiant glow in their eyes. It was an immediate spark, like they were made to be together. That was their first date, and despite everything going on around them, it worked out to just be perfect.
That is just so sweet.
I think I'm gonna cry.
After a few days of the romantic re-engineering, though, Fastwhip showed up looking for the progress on the bomb collars. He strolled into the warehouse with one of the big enforcers and the sniper that was with them when they first captured my dad. My dad tried to come up with an excuse about how they were matching parts and getting the electronics figured out, but all Fastwhip saw was a destroyed pit book.
If you wanted them breaking down, I could have just had Ripper here step on one for you. What I wanted was a little stupid wrist radio converted into a stupid neck radio with a small block of plastic explosives lined inside. Now, I may not be a scientist type like you, but it doesn't really seem that hard to me.
He then glared at my mum, assuming that she was the one stalling. He grabbed her by her tail and pulled her in towards him. He brushed his hoof down her back in a threatening manner.
Perhaps you need a better lesson on how things work around here.
Knowing what was about to happen, my dad spoke up quickly.
Wait, she just took a bit of time to adjusting on the first day. She didn't really take to change very well. But I've spoken to her and we've been working hard since then. Punishment will only shut her down once again and delay the conversation. I need to break the individual encryptions of each unit, which she won't be able to focus on properly.
Fastwhip thought about it for a second. He wrapped his arm tightly around her neck. My mother was breathing fast, looking at my dad while waiting for an answer.
Fine,
he said.
You have a point. And luckily for her, you're here to keep her from doing stupid things and impacting my system.
He released my mum, and my mum ran back to my dad's side. As he was leaving, Fastwhip turned and said,
I want a dozen working units by tomorrow night.
And then he walked out of the warehouse with the other two slavers in tow. My mum cried tears of relief as she clutched around my dad's neck and he calmed her down. Holding her there under the clouded moonlight, my dad found his strength again. He replayed every horrible thing Fastwhip has ever done, all the way back to his parents. Threatening my mum had been the last straw, the final spark that exploded like a bellfire bomb.
Nothing stirs a man's anger like threatening the woman he loves.
With new determination, my dad had hatched a plan and told my mum his ideas. As the days went on, my parents worked quickly. My mum did most of the programming while my dad had disassembled the pit books and put the collars together. At sunset that night, they went around each of the machine stations so they could tell every slave what was going to happen as they were switching shifts. My Aunt Abalone loved the idea and couldn't wait to get revenge. She was feeling guilty that she couldn't do more to keep them from getting captured. After a short rest that night, they worked all the next day getting the collars finalized. They looked at the finished pieces, knowing everything was in place and hoped more than anything that this would work. Fastwhip arrived at sunset. He seemed very satisfied with all of the pit books converted into bomb collars. The enforcer ponies walked up with plastic explosive putty and gave it to my dad, who started putting them into the units. While he did that, my mum showed them the terminal and began explaining how the collars worked.
They're set up in a numerical sequence, she began by saying. All you do is put the name of the slave by the number in this main terminal. That's the master registry, the one that will stay here in the hotel to keep track of all the slaves at the camp. Then, if you take any of them outside of the camp, you just register their number to one of the slave master units. She motioned to the four pit books that looked basically the same as they did before. As they looked, my dad hid a block of explosives beneath his workbench. You set a designated range and all the slaves assigned to that device must stay within a certain distance of the slave master's pit book. Once they leave that area, a steady beep will begin to let them know
It will give them 30 seconds to get back in range before blowing up. When a slave master returns, he simply presses the return to camp button on the menu, and the slaves will be released back to the main transmitter again. All you have to do is connect these two wires to the steel framework of the building, and it will act as the main transmitter within several miles of broadcasting range. Fastwhip ran a few tests with the equipment after blowing up the heads of clothing mannequins, seemed quite satisfied with the work.
Good work, Sparky,
he said in that same sleazy voice.
I'll be equipping tomorrow's away party with this first batch, and we'll hopefully have a fresh set of pit bugs for you soon enough. And you, girl,
he said to my mom.
You have a good head on your shoulders. Try keeping it that way.
She turned away and my dad had to hide a sharp scowl. Fastwhip walked with the box of collars, the slave master's pit bugs, and the main terminal.
Okay, you had my interest, but now you have my unbridled intrigue. What did Sparky do with those hidden blocks of plastic explosive?
They wired them into some of the leftover pit bookcases. With the explosive putty and the transmitter in place, they hid the bombs in the bottom of the toolbox. Then they made their way around the camp to inspect all the different machines. After handing off their additional bombs, everyone was ready. It was already night time, so most of the slavers were asleep. The only ones that weren't were the night guards, which were mainly stationed around the fence. My dad had kept the slaves working so efficiently the past few years that there was a false sense of security. None of them was expecting what was to come. My Aunt Abalone stood waiting at the end of one of the conveyor belts, just under a guard tower where the sniper pony was watching. As he turned to take a leak, Abalone snapped one of the pit bookcases around the metal support beam of the guard tower. By the time he was finished, my aunt was back to her post loading boxes onto the belt. The other bombs were placed in similar tactical points around the perimeter, but they weren't the biggest prize. You see, Fastwhip took the bomb collars to the weapon storage locker in the basement of the Oasis, where two-thirds of his crew were now sleeping. So once night had fallen and everyone was out cold, the time had come. My mom and dad sat down at his terminal area. My mom turned to him.
Ready to go?
She pulled up the program on her terminal.
Wait,
my dad said, pulling her arm away from the terminal. Then he leaned in and kissed her passionately. She wrapped her arm around him and returned the affection. They sat up, still embracing.
In case we don't get a chance later,
he said.
We will,
my mum assured him, and together they hit the button. For 2 seconds, all of the machines and conveyor belts in the slave camp stopped, signalling all of the slaves working on them. Then came the fireworks. A fireball erupted from the bottom floor of the Oasis Hotel. Those that were watching said that the building literally rose several inches in the air from the sheer force of the explosion. The structure of the building quickly gave way as its weakened support beams buckled, collapsing inwards, totally imploding the structure. At that same moment, the other bombs went off, sending a shockwave throughout the fence and killing several of the guards on the perimeter. The slaves, who weren't surprised by the blast, rushed towards the distracted guards and started wrestling their weapons away from them. Most of them were stunned by the destruction of their headquarters buildings, not noticing the slaves sneaking up behind them. A smaller explosion took out the support for the sniper guard's tower, sending him crashing to the ground. As he tumbled out of the wreckage, my Aunt Abalone picked up his anti-material rifle and blew his head off at point-blank range.
Now that is how all slave rebellions should start, with a bit of romance and a boom.
Everything was unfolding perfectly. The remaining guards were quickly taken out by the armed rebels. My Aunt Abalone took her newly acquired rifle and had the time of her life practicing with it from atop of one of the tool sheds. My mum and dad joined in the fighting as well. They were using some of the weapons pulled off the assembly line. And into the haze of the battle, my dad kept his eye on her, making sure she was safe and protected. And then, when he saw a bruised and bloodied Fastwit pulling a minigun battle saddle off one of the dead enforcers, he warily stood on his feet. Although one leg was obviously broken, my dad raised his weapon, the compressor of the stuff gun will to life, as he started walking towards him. Fastwit took the trigger mechanism in his mouth. He had a fierce determination in his eyes, fighting the weight of the minigun and the battle he had already lost. My dad took aim and fired. A burst of white smoke erupted from the barrel as a solid metal pit bookcase soared through the air. The shielding of the wrist terminal was strong enough to survive the Great War. It was the best ammunition for a stuff gun could use. In less than a second it made contact. The pit book crushed Fastwhip's face as he bit clean through the trigger. The momentum knocked the slave master backwards, crushing his throat and lower jaw. My dad walked up, another pit book case already loaded, and what he saw was barely recognisable anymore. The pit book remained lodged in Fastwhip's disfigured mouth. The blood and life gargled out of him as he struggled to breathe. My dad turned and walked away, leaving the wicked stallion to drown in his own blood.
It's starting to sound like badasses running your family. Remind me to keep on my best behavior if we ever visit for the holidays.
Shit, no kidding.
So, now that they had just slayed their captors, what was the next step for all the freed slaves?
Well, they weren't safe yet. Fastwhip's operation had become a major marketplace for raiders and slavers. Sooner or later, another caravan would show up to buy guns or drugs or bring fresh slaves to trade. The camp was a time bomb, so they had to start moving immediately. They gathered all the supplies they could and started walking into the cold wasteland night. My mum and Aunt Abalone's village had travelled the five highways a bit before they settled in their bridge village, so they had a rough idea of the landscape. They decided their best bet was to head west. There were supposed to be several millions of acres of farmland beyond the last highway in an area known as Plains Country. There was just too many slaves along the five highways. Their new tribe would never be safe until they get past that last highway. Although there was nearly 250 ponies in their group, including children, they were able to travel a good 30 miles that first night. Right before sunrise, they found a few storage trucks along one of the highways and slept in the cargo areas to stay hidden. A few guards monitored the surrounding areas to make sure all were safe. They figured it would be safest to travel at night to stay hidden from any potential slavers that were looking for them. The group continued on like that for weeks. They searched all they could to find hiding places in the wilderness between each freeway. My mum's villagers were fairly new to their group, so the long hours of walking helped everyone to get to know each other and share their interests.
Not to mention they were able to topple their slave masters together. That earns a lot of trust and goodwill in and of itself.
It did. Once they left the camp, the ponies didn't even think themselves as different groups. They fought for their freedom together, so they wanted to stay together. Because of the circumstances beforehand, my parents and Aunt Abalone found themselves as the leader of their new tribe, which meant the responsibilities fell on them to get everyone through the wasteland safely.
What do you mean by circumstances beforehand? I understand your dad's de facto leadership, but what about your mom and aunt? Your dad was 19 years old at the time, so your mom was...
18... And my Aunt Abalone was 21.
So then, how did they end up becoming leaders of their village, especially at so young an age?
My dad wondered that as well, but no one was really talking about the past. Once again, everyone was free. They wanted to talk about their plans for the future. They were all dreaming about what the plain countries would look like and how they would set up their new settlement. My mum and dad talked with each other the most, and my dad had been pretty candid whenever his past came up. He tried to keep it light-hearted. They were still in the blossoming romance after all. But after a few weeks passed and they had grown closer, he felt like he could finally ask about my mum's history, since something she said was still bothering him. In the dark mornings, my parents were part of the first watch. My Aunt Abalone was sleeping nearby, spooning her sniper rifle like it was a lover. My parents were sat back against a rock, facing the fallout of the empty landscape. The outline of the fourth highway was visible in the distance.
Amber glow,
he began. She turned to him, looking up from the eggs they had grilled for breakfast. On that first day in the slave camp, that first time we met, you didn't seem surprised by the situation. You looked as if you had gone through all of that before. Was that your first time as a slave? Did something happen in the past?
Oh, I did say that, didn't I?
She said.
I mean, yes, it was. I was upset about getting enslaved, of course, and losing my friends in the process. But the reason things felt so familiar, because, well, I had lost yet another home.
What do you mean?
My dad said.
Well, I told you about the bridge village where we were captured. And then there was the rest stop we lived at for a while. But that wasn't the first place my sister and I lived. We had lied to Fastwit when he was questioning us about our pit books, because there were no way we could lead him back to where we came from. Our tribe did inherit the pit books from our ancestors, but there were more to the story. I was actually born in a stable, stable 80, and while I wasn't a slave, I might as well have been a prisoner. Our overmare, like the ones before her, believed that the world was completely radiated and poisonous above our burdened home. Every one of them thought that simply opening the stable door would kill us all, let alone going into the wasteland. That might have been a problem in a different stable, but we didn't live in the safe place. We were in constant fear of our lives. You see, Stable 80 had a faulty filtration system, so every few years a plague would break out among the general population. No matter how well we tried to quarantine the infection, at least half of the stable would get sick. We called it the blue flu, because it turned the whites of our eyes a sickly pale blue. They would look like robin eggs, but watery and bloodshot. We'd clean and disinfect all we can after burning the bodies, but the virus kept coming back. Even those who were sick but survived were not safe. Not one of us became immune to the blue flu because the virus was constantly changing. With every new breakout, we'd lose at least a couple of dozen of our neighbours, and they were usually the oldest ones because their immune system wasn't strong enough to fight anymore.
That's terrible. I'm sorry,
my dad said.
Because of that, we really didn't have any elderly ponies anymore. Very few of them ever lived past the age 40. Evermere didn't seem to care about the situation at all. It was just another part of life. Once the plague was dealt with, she'd go into a big public serve campaign to encourage the stable dwellers to do their part to repopulate the stable.
It was strange. After attending a dozen funerals, no one was thinking about sex or babies. But still, she tried to stress that it was about maintaining population. And the weird part was that there would be a small pregnancy boom after the pandemic.
Yeah, that's one of those statistics you'd rather not know about. Biologically, it makes sense in terms of instinctively maintaining the herd, but psychologically, it's kind of...
sick, I know. That's what my dad thought too. But my mum also suspected that the overmare was drugging the food with aphrodisiacs and fertility meds. It was the overmare's way to help the progress along, but as my mum observed...
even chemically advanced lovemaking never returned our population. Stable 80 originally had 500 residents. When I was a filly, that number was below 100. Several more outbreaks of the blue flu happened, and with each year passing, the population shrank and the average age grew younger. When Abalone turned 16, the big plague happened. Everyone over the age of 20 died, including our parents. My sister was now the oldest pony in stable 80. There were 36 of us, and 10 of them were under the age of 5. The overmare was dead as well, so everyone looked to Abalone for leadership. She was always very brave and headstrong, but at the same time she was afraid of the responsibility. I had to convince her to accept the role because I knew she could do it if she just believed in herself. My sister signed into the overmare terminal. She decided we had to get out. We had to open the door, but strangely, when we tried to open the door, it still wouldn't budge. It's like the program was glitched.
But obviously that wasn't a problem for the smartest mare in the stable, was it?
My dad raised his eyebrows suggestively, trying to lighten the mood. He always found the strangest ways to squeeze in a compliment, but my mum blushed at them all the same. Before she could say anything, she was interrupted by a loud snore from Abalone. One of her legs twitched on the cot, matching the sound. They both chuckled at the sight and went on with their morning watch.
That's sweet. It's usually the little moments like that that stand out as the best memories.
That's for sure. As you can tell, I've gotten to hear almost all of those memories.
You're telling it well. It almost feels like they're right here with us.
That's what I hoped for.
So your mother and aunt led the other kids out of stable 80 to escape the blue flu.
They did. But even if the virus were somehow magically cleansed from the stable, they would have still left anyway. The stable was a graveyard. Most of their fillies and colts had watched their parents die from the last big pandemic. It's a place none of them ever want to see again. For them, it only represents death and sadness, which is why my mom never thought of it of home. When they emerged, they discovered that stable 80 was built inside of a small lakeside fishing village. But the lake was dry and the town had been completely obliterated by the hellfire bombs. So they started exploring the five highway wastelands until they eventually settled upon a rest stop. They made use of the supplies from the pre-war vehicles gathered there, but those eventually ran dry. The land was too barren to grow crops anymore, so they had to leave once again. After travelling another large patch of the five highway wasteland, they settled in a wreckage of a collapsed bridge. A ton of vehicles had dropped inwards with the bridge providing protection on both sides. The bridge had once crossed a river, and even though it was dry, the land was still relatively fertile for crops to grow.
So that brings us back to the group of escaped slaves who were now heading back to the wild, uncharted west.
Yep. The stable 80 tribe never went beyond the last highway, so they never actually seen the plains country. But they were simply holding on to the stories that it would be a new beginning for them all. They had seen enough slavery and violence, so they were willing to risk the unknown if it meant they could finally find a place to settle.
This really meant a lot to them.
Of course it did. And to the rest of the tribe, too. They had been surrounded by death and desolation for so long, they just wanted some place away from it all. My mum wanted to finally find some place that was safe, somewhere at least reasonably peaceful, where they weren't constantly plagued by death. My dad just wanted to be away from any other ponies, raiders, slaves, mutants. He just wanted to keep walking until they were all a distant memory.
Did they run into any more slavers on the road?
Luckily, no. There were a few small firefights with raiders, but those were fast battles because the tribe had numbers on their side. For most parts, they weren't able to navigate the landscape and stay hidden. Due to the sheer size of the terrain, it wasn't hard. They had made these blankets that blended in with the colour of the dirt and rocks. It was the best camouflage they could put together given the circumstances. During the day, they slept under them and blended in with the ground, and then at night, they'd wear the blankets as ponchos over their saddlebags. All 250 ponies travelled pretty close. They stayed in a tight-knit cluster with the falls in the middle. That way, no one was ever further than 20 ponies away from anyone else. They almost never lit fires. The group was too big. They'd have to have 24 campsites grouped together, and that would have drawn too much attention.
Not to mention all that smoke would create a lasting signal in the sky.
Right, but no one cared about roughing it for a few months. It was still better than being a slave, where they slept in tightly packed barns on wet straw. Eventually, they crossed the Fifth Highway and continued into the plains country. The land was very empty. The five highways at least had scattered infrastructures and vehicles. But this place, the land of the west of them, was made up of scattered homesteads that sat on several hundreds of acres of each. It was mostly what they had imagined, except for one crucial detail. My parents were expecting the ground to be at least somewhat fertile, since it was used as a farmland before, but they had never considered the war itself. You see, the five highways themselves were a means to an end. They were paved roads that connect cities together, but then even their usefulness was limited because there were so many faster and easier ways to carry things around with airships or using Pegasi technology. There wasn't really a reason to bomb any of it, but the plains country, that was the heartland of Equestria. Vast amounts of farmland as far as the eye could see, or at least it used to be. Instead, my parents and their friends found themselves in a dead land. The fields of crops and food had been replaced with large gaping craters, which made it look like they had set foot on the moon. A thin grey haze hung in the air, as if it was sucking all the colour out of the world beneath it. According to my Aunt Abalone, the tribe stared at it for a long time. Not one of them was sure what to do. Their heads were bowing to the fillies and started tearing up as if all hope had lost. My parents were feeling the same way, but my Aunt Abalone made a crucial observation and she went up to my mom and said,
"Look at where the craters are."
"I know. I don't know why we never thought of it. Of course the zebras will bomb the food supply."
"No, but look at where the craters are."
"Everywhere," my dad said. "It's like almost every field has been hit."
"Exactly. Just the field."
My parents looked again and realized what she was talking about. Even though the fields had been destroyed, the homesteads themselves were still standing, including a large grain silo that stood near each of the houses. My Aunt Abalone continued.
I bet a lot of ponies avoided the landscape because of how bad it looks, which means I bet those silos still have quite a bit of food stored up in them.
After some discussions, they turned to the crowd.
Listen up, everyone!
Abalone shouted.
Unfortunately, it doesn't look like we'll be able to settle here after all. However, has that stopped us so far? Here's the new plan. We are going to navigate our way around the craters and scavenge those homesteads for supplies we can get. Then we keep moving until we find a place we can call home.
She sounds like quite the public speaker.
She was definitely the most vocal of the three. Whenever they needed to address the crowd or change routes, it was usually my Aunt Abalone leading the pack. My parents would just usually drift amongst the herd, talking to the individuals and keeping an eye on the other things around them. After encouraging the tribe, they entered the plains county. They used the rad counters they had to navigate their way along the safest route. The land wasn't nearly as radioactive as they expected. As long as you stayed out of the craters itself, it was safe enough to walk around them. When they reached the first silo, my Aunt Abalone said that she held her breath for a moment, hoping it wouldn't be empty. That's the way she's always been. She'll be very confident and assertive on the outside, but on the inside she'll ruminate on her decisions, always preparing for the worst case scenario. I think that's what makes her such a good leader. Even if something turns out wrong, she's always ready to admit her mistakes and find an alternative. But luckily, when they opened the silo door, they found piles of grain and other stored food provisions.
So they were able to continue traveling west?
Yes, but they had to change their course not long after that.
How come?
Well, they crossed about a dozen properties over the course of the week when they ran into a new obstacle. There was a reason the farms were gathered the way they were. The farmland had once been fertile because of a large river that ran southward through the countryside. And I'm not exaggerating when I say the river was big. Based on their estimates, it was at least 2 miles wide, but they couldn't tell how deep it was because it was too clouded to see through the water. It seemed to go on forever in both directions. My parents thought it might connect all the pre-war industrial cities, which could explain its pollution. The river could have also been soaking up the radioactive runoff from the plains country. My Aunt Abalone thought that that was the reason why the farmlands wasn't as dangerous as it could have been. The war and several centuries of chemicals washing into it had turned the water as black as oil.
I'm sure that's not foreboding at all.
At first, they considered building some kind of raft to cross the river, but they wanted to test it first, so they built a smaller version out of logs and clay and pushed it into the water. They had made a pony-shaped mannequin out of a dead rad roach to be the captain of the ship. It sailed about 100 feet before something splashed out of the water in front of it. The creature had a mouth the size of a full-grown stallion, which was filled with razor-sharp teeth. Its head looked like a dragon with dark blue scales. It had large white eyes which looked clouded, like they were blind. But even if it was blind, its nose and whiskers led it straight to the mannequin's head, which it bit off in a single motion. It held on to the edge of the raft with its claws and chewed the poor dummy. The other serpents approached out of the water and also started chewing bits off it. Within a few seconds, the rad roach mannequin had been completely eaten. As the serpent slipped back into the water, they cracked the raft into several pieces, leaving it as a pile of logs floating helplessly above the black abyss.
So sailing was off the table then?
Yeah. They decided that they'd rather face the slavers than try to cross that. But at least the test helped them come up with a name for the river. B Because of its capacity to deal out death and its location near the five highways, they decided to call it the River Six.
Oh, that's funny.
It was a little morbid, but that's the kind of stuff they did to stay sane. Even with that setback, they were still celebrating their freedom from the clutches of Fastwhip and his slavers. Most of the tribes had been enslaved with my dad for over a decade. So every day of freedom was a blessing. They couldn't help but stay positive and find the humour in even the worst situations.
Absolutely. The world is always going to be dealing out bad circumstances. You might as well find enjoyment in it wherever you can. So, now that their westward journey was over, what did they do next?
They decided to follow the riverbank and head south. They figured that they'd find a bridge eventually. They travelled for several weeks along the shoreline, still raiding nearby grain silos for food and other stored supplies. However, they noticed that the silos were starting to be fewer and further between. More and more of them had been hit with bombs, so the tribe were using their rations sparingly. They weren't sure how long they could make it at that rate. The craters blanketed almost the entire plains now, keeping them bolted onto a narrow beach that ran parallel with the river. But as they considered changing course, they found a bridge. Two bridges, in fact. The bridge stretched from each side of the river and met in the middle on an island. The westward bridge connected the island to the other side of the river was completely collapsed. It looked like it had took a direct hit from one of the bombs. Only a few cables dangled from the remaining of the tower on the other side of the western shore. However, the eastern bridge was miraculously intact. It was connected to a road that ran perpendicular to the river. On the island, there was a giant metal door positioned between two guard towers. A long concrete wall circled the island with several other towers at corners and vantage points. The discoloration along the wall showed that the river used to be several feet higher, flowing along the concrete, but now there is a sizable beach between the shoreline and the walls.
So, were they prison walls or just storm walls?
From the outside, it looked like a bit of both. While the walls were impressive, they weren't nearly as daunting as the giant turret guns mounted on the guard towers. It looked like the island had been fortified for war. The guns looked like they could easily reach the shore, but none of them had moved even a little when the tribe approached the foot of the bridge.
So it wasn't a way across the River Six, but it was also the first unique thing your parents had seen in weeks, and they were running low on supplies, so they couldn't just pass by it.
No, of course not. My family knew that they had to investigate the fortress, but they were afraid of the turrets would begin shooting as soon as they stepped on the bridge. They raised the issue with the others in the tribe and asked what they wanted to do. My parents were always diplomatic. They made sure that most of the tribes agreed on the decisions before proceeding. Eventually, they decided to send a team of 25 ponies to investigate while the rest of the tribe waited at the foot of the bridge and protected the falls. Aunt Abalone and my parents took the lead as the exploration team began crossing the river. The bridge had actually survived the war quite well, much better than its sister anyway. Neither it nor the walls seemed to have any real damage. They had some discoloration from the passing of time, but overall they were very sturdy. As they walked, they noticed that the turret guns didn't seem to react to them at all. The weapons simply sat in their default positions, unflinched by the presence of 25 armed ponies approaching the metal doors. Within a few minutes, the group reached the gate. It was made up of two giant blast doors, which were each 15 foot long and 50 feet tall.
They came together in a triangular corner that pointed back over the bridge. Interlocking metal teeth ran up the crease, which fit so tightly you couldn't even slide a piece of paper through the opening. Written in engraved letters above the metal gate were the words, Mare Island.
Mare Island?
Yes, I know, it sounded strange, but...
Shh. Let's give everyone a moment to picture what Mare Island would look like.
Are you done yet?
Continue.
While it is called Mare's Island, it isn't exactly what you'd quite imagine.
So it isn't a paradise filled with beautiful women?
Well, obviously it is, because I'm from there.
Haha, touche.
But the nature of the place was quite different than that. The only way to gain access to the fortress was by the roadside terminal in the front of the gate. My mum and dad, taking their cue, slid out the keyboards and began working on it. To their surprise, they weren't staring at the familiar green Stable Tech logo, but instead they were looking at a series of crisscrossing rectangles that formed a stylized letter E. The bottom of the glowing blue screen read East Corp Integrated Magical Processor.
Wait, the same East Corp as the terminals that Rose Petal found in Maricello?
Yeah, that's actually one of the things that surprised me about her story. I didn't think anyone else had ever seen those before. I thought they were some kind of proprietary hardware only found at Mare's Island.
Interesting. So your parents hadn't seen them before either, even with all the random electronics your dad had come across over the years?
Nope, it was all new to them. The two operating systems really aren't too different. The biggest difference between them is the way the international program is structured. In simple terms, Sable Tech's Bell Matrix is laid out like a grid with blocks of information stacked in rows of columns, where East Tech's Integrated Magical Processor is laid out in a honeycomb, with data gathered together in clusters in Base Pack 3. The clusters each carry out part of processing in separate pieces that then assemble at the end, unlike Sable Tech, where information is handled like an assembly line and organized sequence.
I think we get the idea. We don't want to lose the audience in the technical details.
Oh, whatever. It's not that hard.
Sorry, I can get carried away. Basically, they're not different from some pony who knows what she's looking at. My mom, especially. My parents were both really smart, but they had different specialities that complemented each other. My mum grew up in a stable, playing around with the programming of the terminals and learning how they tick on the inside. Working on actual spell matrix itself came afterwards. On the other hand, my dad grew up toying around with the physical components, soldering wires and circuits together to get things working again. The programming came later. Basically, my mum and my dad were the perfect marriage of software and hardware.
And clearly the apple didn't fall far from the tree.
Well, yeah, I pretty much hardware from the start.
And I'm quite grateful for that, because this studio probably would have fallen to pieces without you.
No kidding.
You definitely exemplify your parents' bright minds. I'm sure it didn't take them long to figure out how to work the East Corp terminal.
Oh, no. Once my parents got past the difference in software, the terminal wasn't a challenge at all. My mum had the encryption hack within a few minutes. With the final keystrokes, the gate opened. The teeth of the large metal door separated with a blast of dust. 2 centuries of dirt and pollution coughed up from its opening. As the entrance was reawakened, it clearly hadn't been open in a long time. Loud metal screeching rang out as the 2 doors slid back into the concrete walls. Once the metal doors stopped, the group slowly walked in with their weapons at the ready. Mare's Island was much bigger and more beautiful than it looked from the outside. Beyond the gate, they found themselves in a bright green fields on both sides of a main road. Gardens and fruit trees were scattered all around the area. The plants were much greener than anything growing in the 5 Highways Wasteland.
My dad plucked an apple off one of the trees and took a bite. After tasting it, he handed it to Mum for a bite.
"This is unbelievable," he said.
My mum savoured the flavour.
"It's just like the apples from the stable."
They both plucked a few more for eating as they continued exploring.
Fresh apples. That is something you don't find much anymore. Most of you Wastelanders are probably only familiar with those freeze-dried apples that come in the pre-war packages, which aren't so much apples as they are apple-flavored preservative paste.
There really is a big difference. It's hard going to the freeze-dried after growing up with the real thing. Those of you who came from a stable can agree with me on that. For those like my dad, though, tasting them for the first time, it was like a miracle. They walked past several more orchards down a paved road, which was in very good condition. The pathways circled around the buildings that were scattered on the grassy hills. The building came in all shapes and sizes. Some were classic red brick warehouses, while others were long concrete brutalist designs. It looked like a place that had existed for many years before the war, with new expansions being added in different time periods. But it was one site towering above the tree line that they were drawn to. In the centre of the north side of the island stood a single main tower. The tower had a radio mast and other communications equipment placed on top of it. The tower itself was a rectangular building which was intercepted by three other rectangular buildings in a staggeration fashion. The main tower of Mare Islands was shaped like the East Corp logo.
Well, branding is important, so if they can arrange a building to advertise any ships or Pegasi passing overhead, I say why not.
I don't think they wanted to appear friendly to those passing overhead. You see, the main tower had a wide courtyard that circled it, and within that courtyard there were three massive artillery guns that put the war turrets to shame. These three guns were angled upwards, one pointed at each of the bridge and one pointed south down the length of the island. They were protecting the main tower, if not the island as a whole. The tip of each gun could raise over 10 stories in the air. You could easily tell by comparing to the floors of the main towers. There was a plaque next to each of the rotating housings describing their characteristics. 100-foot barrel, 24-inch shells, 50 miles effective distance, rail-assisted firing delivery. They were possibly the biggest weapons in the world. The Magical Artillery Regional Support Guns, or MARS guns for short.
Mars guns? That's clever. Good thing they were appropriately named. Not that you'd confuse what they were meant for.
They had individual names too. Ares, Phobos, Deimos.
Why not? At least it's more interesting than giving them a bunch of meaningless number designations. Hopefully these Mars guns ignored your parents like the guns on the walls.
They did. Just like the war turrets, these didn't look like they had moved in a long time. Everything had a slight discoloration to it. They showed their age, but they weren't damaged by any balefire bombs. Whatever battles they fought, they obviously won. After looking at those, my parents and the others continued exploring. Mare's Island is shaped roughly like a teardrop, with the end pointing south in the direction of the river flows. When the group reached the middle of the island, they came upon a set of railroad tracks. Like the paved road, they circled almost all of the buildings on the island. The tracks started at a small harbour where cranes ran along the dock. The harbour was completely isolated from the river by a set of gates built into the fortress walls. A single cargo ship floated gently in the water. It was so well preserved. It looked like it had sailed out of the past from a time before the world was plunged into desolation. But the most incredible thing was that, unlike the black, vicious sludge of the River Styx, the water in the enclosed harbour was completely clean. It shimmered like a light blue crystal that was clear enough that you could see all the way down to the bottom. The group was able to tell the full outline of the cargo ship as if it was hovering on flat artificial sea floor. In one corner of the harbour, a pipe flowed with a steady stream of clean water. After testing it hesitantly, the group of ponies drank their fill from the purified spring. Some of them even hopped into the harbour and swam around.
Forget apples, that's the real salvation of the wasteland, fresh water. We'd be able to do so much with it too. We could grow healthier crops, drink far less radiation than we already do, and prevent the spread of disease. But more than anything, every single person in the wasteland could take a nice long shower. Just the ability to wash off some of the grime and smell from the foulest of travelers would be a blessing by itself. And don't think I'm not including you as well, Ten Pony Tower. We might have decent drinking water, but I know for a fact that our shower fixtures are tied into the East River, which is far from a mountain spring.
It's amazing how much dirt can be embedded into your hair without realizing it. You get so used to it being there, you don't even notice it anymore. For my family, it was such a contrast from the barren plains they had left, they could barely warp their minds around it.
It's so perfect,
my Aunt Abalone said.
This place must be loaded with purification talismans.
But then how are we the only ones out here? My dad answered. Could we really be the first ones to disturb it since the war?
Perhaps everyone else was too afraid,
my mum added, gazing up at one of the war guns. It was obviously built to survive the wars, but for who? It doesn't look like anyone's been here for a while. The group could only hear the flowing of the clean water pipes and a gentle breeze over the grass. Once the adventurous ponies got out of the water, they continued down the island. All of the buildings they passed had blue terminals on every door. They knew getting into them would take some time, so they wanted to make sure they cleared all of the outdoor areas first. Soon enough, they reached the southern tip of the island. A large lighthouse rose above the wall at the pointed intersection. Along the southeast wall, they found a huge field of grass sitting in the front of the four long hangars with retractable roofs. One of the buildings had its roof partly withdrawn, and my parents could see the tip of something poking out of the top. They had covered all the grounds on the property, so they thought it might as well be starting off with this building. In a few minutes, my mum had the door open. They entered the building, one at a time, until a dozen of them entered the small vestibule. The area was filled with several lockers containing utility jumpsuits, hard hats and harnesses, all of the gears you need for large-scale industrial work. They opened the vestibule doors and entered the main space of the hangar. There wasn't much light inside of the building, just a few rays of daylight shining through the retracted roof. The first thing their eyes adjusted to was the bright yellow clamps that rose from the floor, suspending some massive objects above the ground. The objects filled up almost the entire length of the hangar building. The group of ponies thought it looked like a blue whale, but one that had grown 10 times larger due to the radiation.
It looked like a gigantic, irradiated whale?
Yes, at least that's what my mum and aunt saw at first. Based on the nature books in Stable 80, that was the first thing they thought of. Even in the faint light, they could see that the object had a dark blue colouring on the top with a slightly different shade of blue along the belly. Then, coming out of its sides were two long pectoral fins that stretched out like it was swimming above them. My parents were reminded of the cargo ship floating in the crystal clear water of the bay. The dozen of them continued along the walkway. There was a complex of offices at the end of the walkway, and they hoped that there would be a light switch in there. A handful of the unicorns were shining light from the horns using a torch bell. My mum tried to focus the amber glow from the horn, but the light wasn't powerful enough to illuminate the belly of the beast suspended above them. That's when she heard a whispered hiss from my dad.
Stop.
The group were quietly alerted when they walked up beside him. The soft blue glow from his horn shone down on a mangled skeleton. The bones were laying inside of one of the construction jumpsuits. A hard hat sat quietly beside the skull. A tall chest lay sprawled open with the contents spilled over several square tiles. It looked like it had been tossed aside in shock. My dad tilted the shoulder of the body so they could see his chest. The skeleton was dusty and dry, having decomposed several decades ago at least. But even with the passing of time, you could still see the black burn holes between the front sleeves of the jumpsuit. The ribs behind the hole had a noticeable scorch mark, like they had been charred. One of its forelegs had what looked to be a pit buck fastened to it. The wrist terminal was much smoother though, while pit bucks had a thick, heavy-duty case to contain their complex technological. This device was much smaller and simpler. It looked like it had a thick bracelet rather than a computer. My dad looked over it a few more times and pocketed the device.
Every pony be careful, he warned.
They continued to the office complex where they found two more bodies with similar burn marks. My mum carefully set one of the skeletons aside so she could sit in front of the terminal.
Hurry up with the lights! This place gives me the creeps,
Aunt Abalone said.
This will only take me a minute.
My mum responded, clicking away on the keyboard.
Did you hear that?
My dad said. Him and two other bucks had their guns trained on the darkness below the belly of the massive object.
There was a repetitive low-frequency thumping. Something was approaching them on the concrete floor. When it came into view, the group saw that each of the thumps were simply a single step of a thick armoured hoof with a rubberized bottom. But armoured wasn't the right word. On closer inspection, the armour was too thin, too tight against the skin.
You would have to be literally bone thin to fit inside that metal suit that stood before them.
The plated armour section looked like it was made out of a medium grey metallic alloy that was finished so it wouldn't shine or reflect light. The metal section along its back looked unusually large, like it was wearing a backpack of the same material as the armour. The tailpiece was fashioned out of a flexible section assembly so that her tail could contort and bend in the full range of motion.
The head of the metallic mare was slender with high cheekbones, giving it enough of a feminine quality to assign its gender. She did not have a horn, but a raised section ran down her arm and neck to have the appearance of a close-cropped mane. As if she were a soldier right out of boot camp. Her metal ears had a black mesh in the middle which looked like they were a cross between a microphone and a speaker. She had no visible mouth, but there were two small nostrils at the end of her nose. She didn't have two distinct eyes, but a single glass visor that weaved across her face. The brow section above the visor gave her a serious look without being explicitly threatening.
So she wasn't painted up with a scary fanged manticore face?
No, besides her metal appearance, she didn't look scary. But she also didn't look like one of those giddy up gal pals toys from before the war. Even still, my dad and the others around him all had their weapons trained on her. She stopped in front of the group and stood still for a moment, then two bright blue pupils glowed on each side of the visor.
Identification,
A synthesized voice sounded from her, despite her lack of mouth.
Her words were loud enough to echo off the walls behind them.
What?
My dad asked, not sure what else to say. She tilted her head towards him.
Please present your identification,
she retorted. They all glanced back and forth at each other, but the metallic mare's gaze was firmly resting on my dad, waiting for him to answer.
We are visitors. We are lost and just trying to find our way out.
Near the back of the group, my Aunt Albalone stood inside the doorway, guarding my mum.
Amber, we have a problem.
What's the problem? My mum asked.
This metal chick with bright blue eyes just walked up to Sparky.
What? My mum said, confused. The way Albalone had said it made it sound like some raiden mare with blue eyes and a metal barding was flirting with my dad.
But once she glanced out of the window of the office, she got a look at the automaton that had approached the group.
Oh no,
she whispered, and then quickly returned to the terminal.
This facility is under Code Black lockdown. All transits between buildings is prohibited.
The robot rejected my dad's incentive that they were trying to leave.
Visitors are required to wear their identification gauntlets at all times. Please present your identification.
Gauntlet?
My dad repeated, and then hovered over to the device he pulled off the wrist of the construction worker. Upon seeing the gauntlet, the blue pupils in the mare visor blinked twice. In response, the gauntlet screen blinked twice, accompanied by a beep-beep sound. The machine looked back at my dad's face.
Identification profile not found. Intruder alert.
Oh, shit. One of the books beside my dad said. The two pupils moved to the centre of the visor, turning the mare into a cyclops.
Lethal force authorised.
And then they all saw a blinding flash of light and fired. In a symphony of noise, all their guns exploded at once. Everything from a small arms burst to the 50 caliber round from Abalone's anti-material rifle rang out in the canvas space of the building. They all blinked and coughed as the gunpowder smoke cleared. The bright flash of the light came from a long rectangular strip on the ceiling above them. The other strips began illuminating in succession until the entire warehouse space was brightly lit by a white industrial lamp. In front of them, the robotic mare stood still. Her large blue cyclops eye was gone. Instead of rows of code were streaming across her visor like a terminal screen. Is any pony hurt? My dad asked.
You might want to answer that question yourself,
Aunt Abalone reported. She brushed the side of my dad's ear where the smoke was drifting off a patch of seared flesh. Just over his left shoulder, a dark black spot of ash was sizzling in the concrete wall.
Damn, I've heard of close calls, but that's almost divine intervention.
Once the coding stopped passing across the robot mare's visor, the two individual pupils reappeared. This time, the mare's synthesized voice sounded much more friendly sounding.
Welcome to Sky Dog number 3. How may I help you?
Overall, the robot was mostly unscathed. Only a few scratches covered her face and chest where the smaller rounds had bounced off. The only noticeable dent was on her right shoulder piece, where Aunt Abalone's 50 caliber round had struck her.
Are you okay?
My mum pushed past the group to take a look at my dad's hair. The hair wouldn't grow back, but my dad couldn't even feel the charred skin. The superheated air had killed the nerve cells instantly, leaving a small scar.
Did you do this?
My dad asked, looking up at the factory lights.
Yes, but I wish I could have done it sooner,
she said, still fussing over his ear.
Amber, I'm fine, he assured her. What's going on?
This whole facility is under its doomsday alarm from the Great War. The main intranet for this place is broadcasting the alert, so I had to isolate the building to its own local area network to shut it down. So,
That's what the Black Code Lockdown is supposed to be,
Aunt Abalone asked.
If that's true, how come we don't hear the alarm still going off?
I don't know,
my mum answered.
Maybe they turned off once every pony was inside the building.
Do you have any questions about our system protocols?
The group turned back to the robot. Her voice was speaking in a normal conversational volume now.
Yeah, sure,
my dad said.
Please explain what we need to do so you won't shoot at us.
Certainly,
she said cheerfully.
Mez Island Industrial Maintenance Yard is a fully self-sustaining civil defence complex owned and operated by the Equestrian Arcane Systems and Technologies Corporation, or East Corp for short.
Oh, well, that explains a lot. Of course some government-affiliated company would be rife with acronyms.
Haha, yeah. It's one of the many I've had to learn over the past years. The robot turned out to actually be very useful.
So what are you exactly?
My dad asked.
I am an East Corp Series 4 Sentinel droid. I am Unit 235, but you may call me Ultramarine.
Ultramarine?
Aunt Abalone said back in disbelief.
Yes, all Sentinel droid units are assigned a specific colour shade designation as a common name that is more user-friendly for individual interactions.
And the fact that you're a clockwork killing machine had nothing to do with it?
My aunt followed.
That is an interesting coincidence. Would you prefer to speak with Unit 285 Periwinkle?
No, it's fine. My dad said, giving Abalone an annoyed face.
That is an interesting naming scheme, because you could end up with the terrifying robots named Ultramarine, or you could end up with the deceptively cheery-sounding ones like Cotton Candy.
We didn't have a Cotton Candy, but we did have a Honey Blossom.
That is fantastic.
Ultramarine continued discussing the security protocols.
Under Tile 83 of Royal Equestrian Code, Mare Island is designated as an essential operation facility, meaning that it is designed to survive all possible threat scenarios. In event of ground-based assault, Mare Island is protected by a 70-foot-tall defensive wall, equipped with 36 laser batteries along the perimeter. In the event of full-scale mega-spell assault, our three state-of-the-art MARS guns are designed to neutralize incoming projectiles before they come within effective range. A magically generated bubble will project from Building 1 to ensure the safety of all personnel on the island. This bubble will stay active until air quality has reached acceptable levels or power constraints requires it to shut down.
Aunt Abalone interrupted her canned response.
Then what does Code Black Lockdown mean?
Code Black Lockdown indicates that Mare Island is currently fighting aerial bombardment or invasion by hostile forces. Those without proper identification or recognized credentials from our employee database will be assumed to be invading soldiers.
Then why did you kill these guys?
Abalone demanded, pointing at the dead workers in the office.
Identification profiles are stored on gauntlets, wearable personal terminals.
Like this one?
My dad raised the bracelet he took off the construction pony. Once again, the robot mare's pupil blinked, and the gauntlet screen blinked and beeped in response. Everyone quickly raised their weapons, preparing to fight again.
There are no identification profiles found on that device. Perhaps it has been damaged.
So, how would you identify someone if it were? My dad asked.
In the event of damage, gauntlets, identifications are confirmed with retinal scanners. Oh dear.
What is it? My dad asked.
My local registry of personal records, including retinal information, seems to be corrupted. And I cannot access the facility service to correct the issue.
This would be very problematic in the event of a code black lockdown.
Oh, you think?
I must report this problem to administrators. However, I am not able to leave my security area.
Which is this building? My dad asked.
Yes, I must locate an administrator that is not currently deceased.
Most of them went silent, gazing down at the three skeletons scattered around them. But my mum had a satisfied smile on her face. She spoke up and said,
I am an administrator. My gauntlet has also malfunctioned. Could you re-register my identification profile?
Certainly. Gauntlet units are stored in the production complex on level 5. Please follow me.
As they walked past my dad, my mum brushed her tail along his neck. Matching her grin, he and the others followed them.
Well, some pony was satisfied with her work.
Ultramarine led them up a stairwell and along a walkway several stories above the floor. With all the lights now illuminating the building, they were able to get a good look at the giant whale that hung above them. The object, of course, was not an actual whale, but something equally menacing that swam in the clouds. Above them, clutched a giant yellow industrial clamp, was a war balloon painted in a very dark midnight blue.
They were moving along its starboard side towards the bow, or the front of the ship. At their elevated height, they were able to look down into the windows to see a long stretch of cabins hanging along its belly. As they rounded the nose of the ship, they saw the words RES New Horizons censored in white paint above the bridge. My dad called ahead to Ultramarine.
So, you said this was Sky Dock number 3?
Yes. Mare Island has 4 fully equipped Sky Dock facilities for construction and maintenance of airships. East Corp was commissioned to build a new class of stealth bombers, intend to carry large payloads over zebra-controlled territory.
So, you're still building this one when Judgment Day happened?
Incorrect. RES New Horizons saw 6 months of service before being damaged during the mission. It has returned to Mare Island for its repairs.
As they passed along the port side of the ship, they saw massive holes in one of the gas bags that was partly stitched. Smaller dents and scratches cover the entire left side of the ship's fuselage. Several of the cabin windows were shattered.
Along the port side, a handful of the other sentinel droids began flying around inspecting the damages.
They were more masculine looking, like stallions, and had a set of robotic wings with small thrusters attached.
These flying robots were coloured brightly yellow with black highlights. My mum asked,
what are they doing?
Those are Series 3-C. Construction Application Sentinel Droids. Although they are commonly called Worker Bees because of their colouring.
They don't look like they've moved for a while,
my mum said, noticing the dust still shaking off the mechanical joints.
Worker Bees go into standby mode in event of code black lockdown. Only when it is lifted they resume their normal operation.
No matter how long that may be?
My mum finished. Aunt Albalone was walking alongside her in a very defensive posture. She did not like these robots. The one leading them nearly killed them before she was prepared to shoot in case it turned hostile.
I wouldn't blame her for being distrustful of robots. It seems like too many of them are one-trick ponies left in some kind of defensive or security mode since the Great War. Really, it's a miracle your mother's technological wizardry was able to reset them.
And yet, Aunt Abalone didn't waste any time taking pot shots at Ultramarine, so to speak.
So, did someone end up clipping your wings?
She mocked the robot, pointing at the nearby construction units. At this statement, Ultramarine stopped. The robot looked back over her shoulder and Albalone shifted her gun, which was pointed forward loosely in her direction.
Then Ultimate's armor backpack opened to reveal two metal wings even larger than those of the worker bees. Besides the thrusters on her wings, they also had laser-tipped weapons at the points. She retracted them back into the armored backpack and continued walking without a word. This only pissed our brain off more, to the point that my mum could hear her growling. She put her hoof on her sister's back.
"I'm sure glad you have that gun,"
my mum said to her.
"One more shot and I bet you could take off her leg."
She motioned to the dent in the shoulder piece. Albion finally relaxed and hugged her sister. My dad would later ask my mum about this to better understand what happened. You see, my aunt Albion has always been very protective. When she and my mum were growing up, she would always be there at my mum's side to help take care of her when she was sick. There, mum often had to take her back to her own bed so she wouldn't collapse. Albion was the older sister and she felt that she was supposed to be the protector. This was especially true when their parents died of blue flu. You have to imagine her, a 16-year-old girl standing in front of a group of kids and suddenly surrounded by the dead bodies of all the adults. She was the oldest one left in the stable, and she knew that if she didn't do something soon, they all were going to die. But even as Overmare, she found that she had no power to get them out. The stable door was sealed tight, and there was nothing she could do. It was only thanks to Amberglow, her little sister, that they were able to finally escape. And as proud as she was of my mum, it still made her feel hopeless.
That's not how things should be. Amberglow shouldn't have to carry any of the weight.
So when they were on the surface, Abalone was determined to find the young survivors a new home. They travelled for weeks before finally settling in the old rest stop that had a small patch of land with trees and shrubs. She was happy they finally found a new home, and in an area that she could hopefully control and make it better for the ponies she was responsible for. It was in that first year that they learned many new skills. For instance, they learned how to hunt. Too many mutant creatures would show up and try and eat small crops of plants that they were starting to farm. Albion found that she was surprisingly a good shot and quickly taught the others how to shoot as well. Finally, she could protect them and give them the tools to protect themselves. But no matter how many creatures they shot and how well they tried to till the land, they could not get any crops to grow fast enough to sustain them. Abalone couldn't fight elements, and they were at the mercy of nature itself. My mum felt how frustrating my aunt felt and told her that it would be okay, they would find another place to live. So after a few months on the road, they finally found a new location to settle. There were a junction between Highway 2 and 3 that passed over a dried river. Although the river had dried up, the land was still very moist and had sprouted a number of plants and crops. Then Hal had 20 times more farmland than they did at the rest shop. The bridge of the road had collapsed inwards, and the road section had created several pockets and caves that they could reinforce and build off of. After stripping nearby vehicles of their shells and parts, they had a decent-sized village. They had lived there for 3 years in peace, until Faswip's slaver party came after them during the night. As they stormed the village, Aunt Albion fought as hard as she could, but the slavers got hold of some hostages and forced her to give up. The fight had stopped, but they lost three of their friends in the process. It broke her heart. And my aunt Albion had only felt like a failure once again. She couldn't protect those three ponies and the rest of them would live out their lives in servitude. When they were at the camps and Fastwind wanted the pitbull pony, it sent a chill through Abalone's heart. She couldn't bear to watch her little sister die, which is why she immediately offered herself instead.
But my mum was 18 years old, an adult in every sense, and she also didn't want to watch her sister die. In her eyes, Aunt Elberon was more important. She was the leader that had to keep their tribe together through all the hard times. It was later on that Mum told her how Sparky had saved her from Fastwhip and how he came up with the plan to rig the bomb collars. She told Aberyn about the night they spent looking at the pit books and the terminals. She went on about Sparky and the things he had shown her. It became obvious to both of them that Amber Glow had fallen for him. This is how Sparky gained Aberyn's respect. Even though she couldn't protect my mom, my dad had proven that he would be there, and for that she gave their relationship her blessing. Once they were free of the slave camp, it was thanks to Abalone that they were able to pass through the five highways safely. She was the one who came up with the plans to keep them concealed and travel during the night. Besides her own tribe, the runaway colts and fillies from Stable 80. She had now another 200 ponies in her group. Most of them didn't have experience of travelling land, at least not recently. So it was within her guidance and leadership that they were able to make the journey to Plains Country and eventually Mare's Island. And after finding the island, this lush, clean oasis hidden among the rubble of the wasteland, she was not going to give it up so easily. She would destroy every last robot if she had to. Mare Island would be theirs no matter what. But once again, she felt unable to rise up to the duty she'd given herself. It took my mom to stop the killing machines, when Abalone's gun barely left a dent.
So, this went far beyond a healthy distrust of old technology. This was about your aunt fighting to keep her family and friends safe. Yet with every one of her failures, she was racked with guilt because she had placed this impossibly high standard on herself. It doesn't sound like she was jealous at all of your mom's gifts, but was frustrated with her own limitations, and that her sister had to go into harm's way to save her.
That's the gist of it, yes. Abalone is very loving, but sometimes she feels like she has to do the fighting alone. It was only in the last few months that she was realizing how well the three of them worked together as a team. The three of them brought strong leadership to the group that they could have easily scattered after they left the slave camp, and probably gotten themselves captured again.
I think it's time we took a break. I need to hear an I told you so from Rose Petal that she's not the chattiest pony in Ten Pony Tower. We'll grab a fresh beverage, and all of you listeners out there in post-apocalyptia can do the same. We'll be right back.
Somewhere beyond the sea, somewhere waiting for me, I see them waiting on blackened shores, and watch all the ships that go flying. Somewhere beyond the sea, she's there. No more straying for me.
Welcome back, mares and gentle stallions. We thought it was about time for a break because some of us needed a sparkle cola and some of us needed to pee.
Really? You had to say that to the entire audience?
But now we return to Confessions of a Wasteland Pony. Tonight we're sitting down with Amber Horn, our good friend from Ten Pony Tower's generator room, who is telling us the story of her family and where she grew up. We left off with a robot named Ultramarine, leading your parents and their small group through the hangar building, after your mother had successfully hacked through the robot's security protocols.
Well, it's not she hacked through the protocols per se. What she did was isolate the building network from the main computer network that ran through Mare's Island. Once they reached the production complex, my mum was able to outfit all the ponies in their exploration groups with the gauntlet devices. After studying them more closely, my parents guessed that the identification profiles were wiped from these units during the Great War. They weren't built as strong as pit bucks, so they figured the energies being released by the Bellfire bombs must have erased the internal memory. So, in a horrible chain of events, the robot saw that the workers on the island were zebra soldiers and killed them.
Which is probably the worst irony of it all. The devices that were keeping them safe from destruction ended up being the things that killed them in the end.
But luckily, Ultramarine led them to the main server room, and she was able to create new administrative profiles for all of them on their own gauntlet devices. It was then that they put the units to the test. They went to the building next door, another airship hangar, and they were greeted with yet another Sentinel droid. My Aunt Abalone was at the front of the group, her anti-material rifle aimed at the centre of the robot's visor. When the robot's eye blinked, the gauntlets answered in response.
Identification confirmed. System Administrator Abalone, please stay sheltered until Code Black lockdown is lifted. Emergency rations are located in production complex on level 5.
After the robots checked the others, my mum went to the building computer and isolated them from the main network. They did the same over and over again to the 4 dozen buildings within Mare's Island's walls. While doing so, they discovered another large supply of gauntlets in the entrance building by the main gate. From there, they brought in the rest of the ponies waiting outside by the gate and gave them all a gauntlet of their own. Even though the robots were no longer a threat, they wanted to be safe. That's when the rest of the tribe got to see Mare's Island for the first time. Hundreds of acres of trees and crops, and a huge reservoir of clean water, and enough buildings and production shops to create their own industrialized society. The giant metal doors closed behind them, because they made Mare's Island their new home. They would no longer have to face the evils of the world around them.
I'm still wondering why it's called Mare Island in the first place. You said the island was shaped like a teardrop, not a face or some silhouetted figure.
No pony knows for sure. However, almost every pony has their own story about how it came to be, developing their own local legends in the process. My theory is that it was probably a place that young lovers would go for a romantic getaway. It's fun to wonder.
So, your tribe?
The Sentinels.
Excuse me?
Once I settled on the islands, my tribe took their name from the robots. They were the new masters of the Sentinel droids and everything they protected. So they began calling themselves the Sentinels of Mare Island.
Ah, clever. It sounds like a good strong name, and it probably helps solidify their identity as a new settlement of one united group of ponies. Plus, it lets everyone else know that they have this massive supply of cannons and laser artillery at their disposal.
Actually, they didn't have control of the perimeter guns.
What do you mean? I thought your mom had hacked her way through the entire island.
They were able to take control of almost all the buildings with one big exception. My mom couldn't get into the main tower, building 1. She had isolated all the other buildings to their own local networks, but the main server of the heart of Mare's Island was still beyond her reach. The main tower had a higher level of clearance above administrator designation. It required executive clearance, which was guarded by a much more advanced encryption. As much as she tried to break it, she couldn't get through.
So while they had most of the facility under their control, the central building was still locked up like a safe.
Yes, and only inside of the main tower with an executive level clearance can you control the perimeter lasers or the three MARS guns that surrounded the tower.
Okay, so the lasers are only there for visual intimidation, but you've still got this massive 70-foot wall between you and any potential threats, and apparently your parents were the first ones to crack through the door.
Exactly. The island was so very remote that I'd be surprised if a handful of ponies ever stumbled across it. Even if their tribe didn't have such a large caravan to pull supply carts, they could have starved before reaching that far.
So what did they have control over? 4 dozen buildings still sounds like a lot to me, especially for the kind of facility it was.
Oh, quite a bit. The first couple of months were a whirlwind of activities. The first thing they did was set up a new main network to link all the buildings together. They laid down a bunch of new wiring and connected the buildings together through different outlets. My mum ended up calling it the surface network because it bypassed the deep-rooted data lines connected to the East Corp Tower. Once she did that, the Sentinel droids were able to move anywhere within Mare's Island because the combined signal of each building covered the entire area within the walls.
It sounds kind of like the programming your parents did with the bomb callers and the pip bucks.
Oh, it was exactly the same. My dad even began modifying the gauntlet devices to make them more robust, like pip bucks. In the same kind of way, they were able to set up the area programming so that you could take the robots beyond the walls with directives to stay within certain area of view. Sort of like a pet on a leash.
A pet with a deadly laser that it shoots out of its face.
Yeah. It frustrated my mum, though, because she knew if she could only get into the main tower building, she could use its antenna to expand the broadcasting range over a large part of the wasteland. Although, eventually they found a workaround. You see, one of the buildings produced a sprite bot.
Sprite bots? You mean those pink Ministry of Morale floating propaganda speakers?
Yes, I know. The sprite bots Mare Island made were slightly larger and with more military purpose. They had a layer of armor to contain the equipment inside and much sturdier wings. On the underside, they had a smaller laser weapon for basic defense and infiltration. They were built as reconnaissance robots. They had cameras that they used to map areas behind enemy lines or spying on zebra movements. The radios had a long range because of the design of the antenna circuitry and the programming, so it had become another project my parents could work on together in their free time. Although finding ways to fill free time wasn't a problem for anyone anymore. Many of the ponies, especially the ones from Stable 80, became full-time farmers. They began working on the fields where the crops and apple trees grew. The plants had grown randomly and unchecked over the centuries, so with a little bit of planning and work, they were able to produce even more food and organise an efficient harvest schedule. For many of the others, like the technically inclined ones my dad taught in the slave camp, they were plenty of industrialized areas to get working again. Several of the buildings were just warehouses full of raw materials. On top of that, the cargo ship in the harbour, the SS Camel, was also full of supplies that hadn't been unloaded yet. One of the buildings was being used to make clothing, specifically jumpsuits and fatigues for soldiers, but with a little modification they could get them to sew a wide variety of styles. One of the buildings had heavy-duty furnaces and ovens. You could break down any kind of metal and other scraps to create brand new raw materials for other buildings to use. It was an all-inclusive wasteland recycle centre. One of the buildings made guns and ammunition. In there, my dad found a few sentinel droids that had been destroyed by the factory workers before they were killed. So my dad was able to take those droids apart and study how they worked and what they were made of. Several of the buildings were living quarters for the workers. Mare's Island had to have them because they were very far from any big cities, even from the Fifth Highway. It was probably 100 miles to the closest remains of civilizations. Of course, those made great new living areas for the Sentinels. There was another huge blessing. The 200 ponies that had been slaves for a long time, like my dad, slept in warehouse spaces, all of them sharing a big pile of hay. There was no privacy, no comfort, just a flat area not much softer than laying down on dirt. But the dormitories, there were enough room for 1,000 families, over 5,000 ponies. We had more than enough space for everyone. Even their kids had their own room, and every couple had their privacy. So, not surprisingly, there were a lot of pregnancies in that first year.
Soft beds, closed doors, safety and security. Yeah, pretty much just one thing left to do. Each other.
Everything was perfect in its own way. Then, about 2 years later, was a visitor. It was just another normal day at Mare's Island. Every pony was going about their business. That's when the gate guard signalled Aunt Abalone and my parents that someone was approaching the gate.
Someone? Just a single pony? All by themselves?
Yes. He had some heavy saddlebags, but he looked like he was on the brink of starvation. He trotted up slowly to the control panel and pushed the comms button.
Hello? Is any pony in there? Please, help me. I escaped from a slaver's camp to the east. They tortured me for months and I barely got out alive. I am almost out of food and water too. If there's any pony in there, please have mercy. I can walk. I can earn my keep. But first, I need water.
My parents and Aunt Abalone were listening to his transmission in the security office. It was an area that they turned into a capital building. It was located on the main road between the gate and the main tower.
What should we do?
My Aunt Abalone asked.
Can we risk anyone knowing we're in here?
If we did let him walk away, he looks like he'd die before telling anyone he found this place.
My mum responded.
How could we turn him away?
My dad asked.
We were all slaves once too, and we had to walk the same hard road he did. And he did it by himself.
My dad had been a slave for a very long time. Of the three of them, he was the most emotionally connected to the situation.
But do you think we can trust him?
My Aunt Abalone asked.
Between our guns and sentinels?
I don't think this frail book poses a threat to us.
Dad rationalised.
Yeah, you're right.
Abalone agreed. After receiving a nod of approval from my mum, she opened the gate. The metal door slid open and the stallion hobbled on his walking stick with a hopeful look in his eye. A look that quickly disappeared when he saw the metal sentinel droid on each side of the gate.
Please, don't hurt me,
he cried.
You can take my bags. All I have is this pistol.
He laid the saddlebags in front of one of the robots and they inspected him. He had another coughing fit and leaned on his walking stick to stabilize himself.
What is your name?
One of the gate guards asked.
Silverstep,
he replied.
Thank you. Thank you for letting me in. There's no more places to rummage down here.
As soon as he saw my parents and the others walk up, he continued.
I've been walking for a very long time.
Will you be all right now? My dad said. Come with us. We'll get you something to eat and you can tell us about yourself.
They all went with Silverstep to one of our chow halls and laid out one of the long tables for a meal. It was around lunchtime anyway. They all sat together and feasted on apples, corn and barley.
Many thanks to you, Mr. Sparky,
he said, choking down food.
Your kindness is a blessing from the goddesses.
We are happy we could help,
my dad responded.
We were once enslaved ourselves, but we fought for our freedom and found our home here.
And what a home it is,
he exclaimed.
A herd of robot mares to your disposal. That sounds like a dream come true, if you ask me.
He laughed in a very suggestive way. The food was already returning his energy. He was very joyful and lively. Their initial impression of Silverstep as a older stallion was proving less accurate. While he did have a silver-grey mane, it appeared to be more natural due to age. In reality, he was probably barely older than 40.
Yeah, he couldn't have been too old. I'd imagine you'd need a certain amount of youthful energy and endurance to make that long walk across the wasteland.
And he seemed pleasant to talk to.
So, Mr. Silverstep,
my Aunt Abalone asked,
you said you escaped a slave camp too?
Oh yes, it was a terrible place, ruled by a heartless slave master called Lockjaw.
Lockjaw? My dad asked.
Yes, he's the tall, brooding monster of a book. He looks like he ate other slavers just to consume their muscle mass. He always wears a mask with a manticore fang carved into it. And he has a deep, growling voice that seems to echo out of the mask like a loudspeaker. He has monsters in every sense. Even through whipping and the hard labor, though, I was filled with hope when I heard stories of a group of slaves that had destroyed their camp and escaped. I believe I actually get to meet you all in person. Put faces to names. Sparky, Amberglone, and Abalone.
I didn't know we'd left a reputation, my mum said with a worry in her voice.
Oh, yes. It's finally what gave me the chance to get out. I had to get out.
Silverstep's happy tone began to falter.
I had to get out. They took my family away from me. My sweet wife and daughter. And I need to get them back, no matter what.
I'm so sorry to hear that,
my dad said.
Slave masters can be cruel in ways that they separate families.
They can. Is there a restroom I can use?
Sure, down the hall to the left,
my dad said. The stallion got off his chair and slowly started hobbling with his walking stick. He passed a few other sentinel droids that were seated with the group at the table. But then, as he walked behind my mother, his movements suddenly became very swift and practiced. In one motion, he twisted his walking stick round and pulled a 4-inch blade from the hilt. He grabbed my mother off her chair and brought the blade tightly around her neck.
Son of a bitch!
Everyone jumped in response as she screamed.
Get back!
Silverstep shouted.
Get back!
He pressed the blade closer against my mother's neck, and a small trickle of blood dripped onto her collar.
Everyone, step back!
My dad shouted. The 4 sentinel droids in the room all had their cyclops lasers trained on Silverstep, but he was holding my mum too close. None of them had a clear shot. My Aunt Abalone ran out of the room.
Let her go,
my dad demanded.
What is this?
You've made a big splash, Mr. Pitbuck. Every slave master across the five highways has heard about this stunt you pulled. It's causing a lot of unrest amongst the slaves. Because of you, they all have become more vicious than before. Anyone caught talking about the bombing of Oasis is immediately executed. This is what the ponies like me are for. I was one of the captured ones with a family that I loved, and not just mine, but hundreds of families, all being used as leverage because you took down one of the largest operations in your little dash for freedom. So now all of us live under an ultimatum. If I don't return with you or any information that can lead them to you, then my wife and daughter are dead.
Please, let her go. We can talk about this,
my dad pleaded.
There's no time for talk. If I'm not back soon, they're going to start prostituting my sweet little girl. But luckily, that isn't a problem anymore. I want a ship, and I'm taking your bitch with me.
Of all the terrible circumstances.
Outside of the building, my Aunt Abalone had taken her sniper rifle and was lining up a shot through the side window. He was holding the blade in his right forehoof and had my mum's arm pinned tight. From a vantage point on the top of a nearby building, Abalone lined up the shot through his temple. If she could blow his head clean off, the natural reaction would to be loosen his elbow in a pointless attempt to stop the bullet that had already destroyed the brain. But she was breathing hard. Abalone had never seen her sister so close to death. Such an intimidating threat placed coldly against my mother's throat. As much as she tried to calm herself, her heart was racing fast. Once she felt calm enough, she took the shot. The anti-material round exploded out of the gun barrel and sailed through the air. It shattered the window and approached Silverstep with my mum held close. Unfortunately, Abalone had pulled to the left instinctively that so she wouldn't hit her sister. But that reaction was too much. Instead of exploding his head, the bullet grazed his shoulder. The sudden pain was enough that Silverstep twisted his arm, pulling the blade away from my mother's neck. But no one in the building knew when the shot would happen. Before they could react, Silverstep plunged the knife into my mother's stomach. She screamed in pain, and Silver Star was reduced to ash by a collective burst of laser fire from the Sentinel droids.
By the goddesses.
They quickly got my mother to the hospital building. She was bleeding heavily, and they had to act quickly. The knife had gone deep, damaging her intestines, stomach, and uterus. And there, in the operating room, covered in blood, is how they found out she was pregnant.
Oh, no.
My mum was still conscious at that point when she heard she was pregnant, and my Aunt Abalone said her eyes lit up.
I'm going to have a baby,
she said happily. The doctor explained that even if everything healed up well, the pregnancy would still be very dangerous. But before he could continue speaking, she said,
Save the baby,
Amber,
my dad pleaded.
The risk is too great. You could...
There will be no way I'll be able to conceive after this.
Before slipping into unconsciousness, she said one more time,
Save the baby.
Damn it, Amber.
Abalone muttered, tears rolling down her face. They all fell silent as the medical sentinel droid began stitching her closed.
Amber, maybe it's time for another break.
You see, both of them were right. 6 months later, I was born, and my mother died in the process. My mum was hopeful, but ended up sacrificing her life for me anyway. My dad and Abalone knew what would happen. They knew I was a mistake from the start.
Who on earth told you that? It wasn't one of them, was it?
Of course not. They would never tell me the truth. I had to learn it all from the medical droid's files years later.
I'm so sorry that happened. But ponies don't always mean what they say in the moment, and they can never see into the future. Your mom clearly wanted the best for you no matter what. I'm sure your dad and your aunt loved you.
I didn't even decrypt the files until I was 13, when they actually told me what happened. Up until then, they had said my mum got sick after I was born. Some latent strain of the blue flu. It was a well-constructed lie. I didn't even question it until they told me about Silverstep.
But clearly they were trying to protect you, because they cared about you. They didn't blame you for her death.
No, they didn't. It was quite the opposite, actually. Both Abalone and my dad blamed themselves. My dad cursed himself that it was his idea to let the stallion through the gates in the first place. He felt that it was because of his misguided altruism and trust that he ended up getting my mum killed by putting her in a dangerous situation for the sake of a total stranger. Aunt Abalone, on the other hand, felt guilty that she had missed the shot at Silverstep's head. It destroyed her inside. She failed in a situation that she should have had total control of. She should have had the Sentinel droids take his walking stick. She should have kept him shackled until they determined he wasn't a threat. But ultimately, she failed at doing something she was supposed to be the best at. Shooting was one of the things she knew really well. It wasn't like before, when my mother had to hack the robot's programming. That was just some random book. And all she had to do was take a shot. And she missed. Neither of them cast any blame on each other. Or me. Because they felt so guilty in their own way. For all them reasons, my mum's death really defined what Mare's Island would become, and how Sentinel society would develop.
How do you mean?
To start, my dad was one to suggest they let the stallions in. He decided he did not deserve a leadership position, as it had been. Beforehand, in those first couple of years, Sparky, Amberglow, and Abalone led their tribe together as a sort of council of three ponies. But with my mother dead, and my dad feeling guilty for it, he completely abdicated his official role and declared Abalone the chief sentinel of Mare's Island. My aunt Abalone did not want to end up being a director, so she set up a series of departments to organise all of the work and functions on the island. Department of Education, Department of Agriculture, Department of Medicine. She made sure that each department had a capable chief that would make the best decisions when they could for the things they oversaw. She met with all department's chiefs once a week in a regular meeting to take care of normal operations. The first chief of medical was the doctor who recommended terminating me.
Oh, Amber.
But that made sense. The reason they brought my mum to him in the first place because he was the best doctor in the group, and the others knew what they were doing too. Soon enough, everything was running well, and the first batch of foals that had been born after the island was discovered began attending school. All the technology we had was integral to our daily lives. So from a young age, our schoolings were focused on learning how to do just about every job on Mare's Island. They wanted to make sure that every pony could take another's place in case something happened.
What about you personally? How were things between you, your dad, and your aunt? What were things like for you growing up?
They always did want me to know about her, to have a connection to her. Even my name, my Amber Horn, are tied to her. That was the main reason Abalone always stressed that she was Aunt Abalone. She never wanted to replace my mum in my mind. So that's why they told me so much about her life and adventures, so I could know her and who she was.
So all these stories, all these moments of love and triumph that you've been telling us this evening, they are your collective knowledge of her, the way you feel close to her.
My mom was a great mare. She was sweet and loving and gave inner strength to all those around her. Both my dad and Abalone believed that without her, so much would be different. Without my mom, Abalone and the others would have died in stable 80. And without my dad falling in love with her, he might have never found the strength to rise up and destroy Fast Whip and his slavers. She's that kind of mare that deserves to be remembered. That's why they told her story to me, and that's why I wanted to tell all of you.
And I'm sure she would be very happy to hear you say that.
I hope so. I like to think she can hear me. After I was born, as you can imagine, my birthdays weren't exactly a joyous occasion. My dad and the others did their best to put on a happy face, but every other year I'd find Abalone hiding somewhere, crying softly by herself. I was told I was a lot like her, that I had a similar personality and skills. Even from a young age, I would tinker around with terminals. My parents had limited resources at their disposal when they were growing up. My mum only had the computers in Stable 80, and my dad only had the technology he had to sort through. I wasn't limited in any way. I was born into a motherload of technology. Even as a foal, my dad would have me right there on his lap whenever he was taking something apart. He'd tell me about every piece and explained how they worked. Aunt Abalone said that when he did, he had the same sparkle in his eyes like when he and my mum were building something together.
That is so sweet.
As I got older, I grew more and more experienced with coding, until one day when I was 7 years old, I was able to crack through the executive level encryption.
Wait, is that the same encryption for the main tower building that controls the perimeter lasers and the Mars guns?
That is how I got my mark, which just looks like my mum's. Except instead of a green stable tech server, mine is a blue East Corp server.
That's incredible. As just a little filly, you were able to do something even your mother couldn't do with more years of experience.
My dad figured it was because I had worked with East Corp technology from the start. They still approached everything from a spell matrix frame of reference. And I say they because at that point everyone on the island was trained in computer science and engineering. Knowledge is power, and it's the same thing that brought us out of slavery in the first place. So it's something we value very highly. But I should clarify, breaking through the door encryption and creating an executive level identification profile are not the same thing. Same as when my mum first got into the airship building. She had to work non-stop on her terminal for 5 minutes before finally lifting the alarm. And the executive level encryptions are so much more complicated.
the only way I got through in the first place because I developed a random number generator that wouldn't trigger the software lockout procedure.
So you're saying...
It was incredibly risky. If we did open the door, there was a chance we'd find an even larger, more powerful Sentinel droid inside. I'd never be able to work on a turbo long enough to actually disable the code black lockdown. So, once again, something I did was being brought up as a major matter before the Sentinel Council. They ultimately voted it was too risky and wished to continue our current defensive plans.
They had other plans in the works?
Well, another thing that the Silverstep incident changed was Mare's Island's interaction with the outside world. He had kind of killed one of the most loved mares of our tribe, one of its leaders. In one action, he had exhausted all possible goodwill they might have had for the other escaped slaves and travellers. As far as the council were concerned, the slave masters had turned all of the innocent ponies of the world against them. So, from that point forward, no one was in and no one was going out. Instead, they got the Sprite Bot building running at full capacity and sent out a network of floating robots to monitor the surrounding areas. They were our first line of defence, a warning system in case of a hostile activity approaching. My dad and the others developed stronger lasers for the Sprite Bots to use. They were not small defensive weapons anymore. They were meant to destroy any target that tried to get close to the island. The Sprite Bot network was extremely effective. It had driven away all of the mutant creatures to the surrounding areas, and in doing so, created yet another protective layer between us and the five highways. On top of that, several of the buildings were there to produce laser guns and magical energy weapons. Soon enough, every pony on Mare's Island had a rifle, a sidearm, and knew how to effectively use both. We lived like we were in a state of eternal war, constantly preparation for the next time something would come knocking at our door. We didn't need the perimeter laser or the MAR guns. Heck, we had 100 of the military-graded Sentinel droids and 500 more of the general-purpose units that performed a wide variety of tasks. Between all of them and the hundreds of Sprite Bots we had patrolling the deserts, we were safe from any potential problem that could arise.
That might have been what the Council thought, but what did you think? What did your dad think?
We were... conflicted. Breaking through the executive encryption was something that my mum had wanted to do for a long time. It was one of the last things she was working on when she died. My dad was so proud when I did it, so much that every year we started celebrating my mark instead of my birthday. And that became a truly festive occasion. But at the same time, my dad was relieved by the council's decision. I was still a filly, and there was no way my dad wanted to risk taking me into such a dangerous place. He had watched the death of almost every family member he had ever loved. He watched my grandfather being whipped to death. He watched my grandmother get shot in the head. And he watched my mother get stabbed and later die. Giving birth because of it. The only family he had left were me and Aunt Abalone. She felt the same way. It was because of her deciding vote on the council that they rejected the plan to open the tower building. She had failed to protect my mother in a situation where she should have had total control, but made mistakes. There was no way she was going to allow me, a young filly, to be put in harm's way trying to take command of the tower. If Aunt Abalone couldn't go in and shut down the robots herself, then no one was, especially her sister's only child. A lot of my childhood was like this.
Abalone and my dad came to similar conclusions from different vantage points. Whenever that involved my mother, it came out of shared sense of guilt.
That's terrible, though. Living weighed down by guilt? That's one of the worst things you could do to yourself. How can you live if you are constantly allowing yourself to be haunted by your own past mistakes? That would just destroy you inside.
They felt it was their burden, the weight they had to bear, so they would never make those mistakes again. They knew how costly those mistakes could be.
Okay, so you didn't go into the tower right away, but you had effectively opened Pandora's box. You couldn't undo discovering the key, and I'm guessing there was no way you could stay out forever.
That's true, but it wasn't our decision to make. It took another incident to push us further in that direction. One day, after I turned 17, an alarm went off in the Sprite Bot server room. It was an emergency alarm. One of the bots had disappeared from the network. This was a pretty big problem. The Sprite bots, especially in the early days, got into battles with some kind of mutant animals all the time. They were signal us that they were shooting at something, but the Sprite bots would always win. They could incinerate almost all the creatures that had come nearby. Every other year, they even killed a random raider that stumbled their way into the plain countries. But having a sprite bot go off the grid had never happened before. Abalone and the other sharpshooters examined the horizons where the sprite bot would be. They looked for mushroom clouds. Maybe one of the craters had an unexploded Bellfire bomb that had been set off somehow. They didn't see anything. It hadn't even given off a signal it was engaging something in combat. The robot just disappeared.
How strange.
Understandably, we investigated. We directed several nearby sprite bots to focus their patrol in that area. Hopefully, we'd find a clue to what happened. But when we looked at the video footage, we didn't see anything significant. The missing unit was the one that patrolled the closest to the fifth highway, so we figured that it must have been a part of what happened. After that, things went quiet for again. Life went on, months went by, and I celebrated my 10th mark day. Things were normal. Then another alarm went off in the Sprite Bot room, and the operator summoned all three of us immediately. One by one, every sprite bot began disappearing off the network. They blinked offline like a wave was approaching the River Six. My dad ordered that the computers be disconnected from the surface network, and it was. Eventually, the last sprite bot disappeared. The antenna on the top of the building blinked by itself in the night, talking to nothing. The snipers on the walls were able to see a few of the closer sprite bots that patrol near the shoreline. Once their signal blinked out, they stopped and floated in place for a few seconds, then each of them would turn and start traveling east towards the five highways.
What? How? What could have done that?
I looked very closely through all the codes, the broadcasting terminals that had picked up quite a bit during the last moment. It looked like some foreign computer had taken over each of the units and severed their connection with us. In one day, they had stolen our entire fleet of sprite bots. Just like that, a major part of our defense was gone. Even if we had made more, it would take a long time to replace them, and we had just no idea how their code was being overridden in the first place. Now we had much more pressing needs to get to the main tower. We had to get the perimeter lasers working. It had been years, and I wasn't a filly anymore. I convinced Anne Abalone that I could handle it, and with a team to back me up, I could crack the code. Abalone, my dad, and I were accompanied
by a dozen sentinel droids and four other ponies to back us up. I put the access code that I'd uncovered over a decade before, and the door to the building slid open before us. We had entered the easternmost building, the one that was closest to the main gate. What we found inside was the first thing we expected. Of all the buildings on Mare's Island, there was one that had been noticeably absent. The sentineled manufacturing building. In front of us were rows after rows of assembly lines that could build sentinel droids of all shapes and sizes. They were the one thing on Mare's Island that had remained constant. Our population grew, we grew more crops, and we were able to build more guns, more sprite bots, and more clothes. But we had no way to make more sentinel droids. We could only patch up the ones that needed it to the best of our abilities. Up ahead, we saw one of the officers, and the group quickly rushed me in there. I sat down and began working. It wasn't long before one of the tower sentinel droids approached the group demanding to see identification. After Aunt Abalone's gauntlet failed the test, she, my dad, and two of the other bucks all fired their weapons at the robot's neck and blew off its head. At that point, the eyes of several heads started blinking and a bunch of other sentinel droids began approaching the group. The 12 sentinel droids we brought with us began engaging the other ones from the main tower. All of the sentinel droids had basic priority targeting programs. That means they'll shoot the most dangerous threat first, which in this case were the other sentinel droids. I was sweating hard at that point. With each of the laser bursts, I felt another shot of adrenaline run down my spine. Abalone shouted inside,
"We're starting to lose robots. You've got 2 minutes."
"I can do it," I yelled back. I tapped away as fast as I could, reading each character in line as soon as it appeared on the screen. I was getting close. I knew it. I was only a few steps away from the gate, but that is when I heard the scream, a blood-curdling yell from one of the mares that was backing us up.
"It's too late,"
my dad said.
"We have to go."
"No, wait, I've almost got it."
"It's too dangerous."
Before I could protest, he picked me up and pulled me onto the back, and then we galloped out of the main building the way we came. We lost all 12 sentinel droids and one of the mares that was helping us, and I was so close. I could have had it in a few more seconds. But that was it. I failed my attempt, and we had lost a tenth of our military-grade sentinel droids in the process. Which meant when something came for us, we had that many less to defend ourselves with.
Okay, things didn't work out, but you were still able to do something incredible by getting in there in the first place. Plus, that was only 12 sentinel droids out of how many?
A little over 100, plus about 500 more non-military sentinel droids, like the worker bees, medical robots, and etc.
There you go. I'm sure your family were already in the process of arming them.
No, actually, we couldn't. The military type ones were the only ones that we could use for fighting. The others were very specialised in the specific kind of programming or purpose they were made for. The only way we could have turned them into fighting machines is if we gained control of the Sentinel Droid factory and used the computers to rewrite their source code. Plus, by just having control of the factory, we could build more droids. In fact, if that building worked like the others, we could build all the droids we ever want, an entire army of clockwork killing machines. That's what we had done with the sprite bots, and now that we're gone, over 1,000 floating laser rifles stolen from us.
But that didn't matter, did it? The Sentinel droids were larger and more capable.
It wouldn't take us too long to find out. In a few short weeks, our scouts on the wall alerted us to something approaching. From her anti-material rifle, Abalone saw the sprite bots all floating over the hillside like a blanket of metal fog. But they weren't alone. Behind the sprite bots were four large buses. They were each being pulled by four stallions at the front. But there was a noticeable glow in the harnesses. There were working spark batteries in the buses to help them move forward. They allowed the buses to float gently off the ground so the drivers didn't feel like they were pulling much at all. On the top of these buses were railings. Several ponies were sitting on the roof of each vehicle. They were dressed in various types of armor and all were armed. They were slavers, probably some with raiders or hired guns among the group. After all this time, they had found us.
Oh, goddesses. How on earth could they be doing it, though? How could they track you down from the sprite bots? Or take them over, for that matter?
They were not the same as the slavers my parents had escaped. This was a well-organized garrison of basically soldiers. Someone among them had incredible technical capability to not have only harvest those buses for parts, but to get them up and running again. That's not an easy task. A lot of these components degrade over years, so gathering a full set for working vehicle is almost unheard of. And yet, here, sailing towards the shores of the River Six, were four fully loaded buses of armed ponies. But the buses weren't what alarmed us the most. Behind them, rolling along the broken desert road, was a large battle tank.
A tank?
A very, very big tank. The behemoth rolled over the hills with four massive tank treads. The armour of the body was coloured a standard army green, but you could still see the remains of the old equestrian flag painted along the side. It was remarkably good condition, like they found it sitting in an old military storage depot. Sitting atop the tank was a turret gun, even bigger than the laser batteries we had along the perimeter wall. It rolled between the buses and the sprite bots and came to a stop by the foot of the bridge. The sprite bot radio transmission came to life again. This time it broadcasted more than just a data stream. We heard a voice coming through the speaker. It was a deep, gravelly voice, but it had a bit of a metallic tinge to it. It sounded heavily synthesized.
Knock, knock. Is anyone home?
My dad actually fiddled with the speaker cables, thinking there was something short somewhere.
I'd like to introduce myself. My name is Lockjaw.
Lockjaw? Isn't that the same slaver that blackmailed Silverstep to look for your parents?
The same one. At that time, it made sense. The slavers couldn't let word get out that a large group of slaves had escaped, or even if it did, they had to make sure that the final words was that they were all tracked down and dealt with. At the time, it would have been a pretty big prize for slavers. There were over 250 of us back then. They could repopulate an entire camp all over again. But apparently, the passings of the year hasn't stopped their pursuit. The slave masters wanted revenge. The Sentinels were having more and more foals every year. We could start families because we were safe in our secret part of the wasteland. So now, the prize was even bigger. There was over 500 of us. There were so many that we could fill up 10 of their buses. My dad and I were watching from the Capitol building, where we had moved this Brightbot transmission so we could monitor the radios. While listening to the gravelly voice coming over the speaker, Abalone messaged us too.
Guys, you might want to switch to the zoomed camera. Look at the tank.
We did so, and saw that the top had opened up. A bubble shield was protecting the pony that had now stood up through the hatch in a gun turret. Abalone, of course, tried shooting it a few times, but none of the bullets went through. By the time the camera zoomed in on the pony, my dad had turned pale with his mouth hung open.
Is that any way to treat an old friend?
The gravelly voice responded.
Behind the soft glow of the bubble shield, the pony took off his black gaucho hat, revealing a light grey coat and a thin black mane.
It's been a while, Sparky.
Oh, goddesses.
My dad started muttering to himself at this point.
He's alive. How could he be alive?
The pony in the tank was speaking through a robotic metal jaw. There were enough artificial pieces in his neck, chest, and face that you could fairly call him a cyborg.
Did you have a hard time recognizing me at first? I have to thank you for that. In fact, once Ripper had carried me over to the nearest camp, they almost couldn't save me. They had to completely rebuild my face with the few materials they had available. The only real problem was that my jaw had been locked shut.
There was so much venom in his words, it sounded like he would bite the microphone.
So, from that point forward, Fast Whip didn't seem appropriate anymore. For nearly 20 damn years, I had to drink everything for a straw. But, as you can see, I was recently given a new lease on life. I met a new employer who has access to things you can't even imagine. You're not the only one with toys in the wasteland. He gave me back my face, and I swore allegiance to him. How lucky was it that it was one of my scouts that happened to stumble across your little bot squall. I recognized your handiwork the first time when we cracked one open. My employers gave me in charge for them, and I promised him I'd bring you back as many as you as I could. I vastly overestimated you when you were in my service. You can't even hold on to your own robots. In fact, I bet there's a lot of things you can't do.
Before either of us could answer him, we heard a loud explosion. The battle tanks fired a large shell at one of the perimeter lasers. It was pushed sideways on its turret's mount, and a large dent was made in our outer assembly.
Pathetic.
He spat again.
You hide behind a gooser of powers, but ultimately it's just a show. You're just a prisoner in a cage. You'd like to be a lot more useful in my master's employ. So, what's it going to be, Sparky? If you surrender now, all of you will survive. I'll even let you and that bitch of yours live. You have proven yourselves useful. It'd be a waste to bite out your throat with my titanium teeth, no matter how much I want to.
He didn't know what happened to your mother.
He didn't know a lot of things. He didn't know that we would never allow ourselves to be slaves again. He didn't know that we'd fight to every last pony if we had to.
Before my dad could answer, Aunt Abalone spoke over the radio. She had been listening to the whole thing.
Sparky,
Would you kindly tell him to take his damn robot and go fuck himself?
Ha ha!
And from there, the sentinel droids on the wall began firing at the sprite bots on the beach.
Kick ass.
It was a very chaotic beginning. The tank started firing along the walls, trying to take down any clusters of sentinel droids they could. But the droids were way too fast for them. They clearly didn't know much about tanks. It's probably their first time using a gun at all. Unfortunately for us, the tank's armor was very strong. Even the combined laser fire of a dozen sentinel droids wasn't getting through the thick plating. The tanks was rolling along the bridge now, getting closer to the walls to improve its aim. Its rounds were very large, the thickness of a pony's hoof. However, they couldn't do anything to the walls or the gate. They were built so thickly they didn't even make a dent. But still, the round sailed over the gate, forcing the sentinel droids and our snipers to retreat backwards along the perimeter. The tank's rounds were dropping all over the island, crashing through buildings and blowing up trees in the orchards.
What's going on?
My dad demanded.
How come the turrets aren't defending us?
Oh, that's true.
Ultramarine was with us in the computer room and explained.
The primary reactor must have been overloaded while projecting the bubble shield over the island. In order to restart them, it requires physical activation from an operator in the system command center.
I answered her, saying, so, we've been on backup power the entire time?
Yes,
Ultramarine answered.
Mare's Island draws alternative power from a collective of high-capacity spark batteries, which feeds off the geothermal and hydrodynamic network below the river. This network can power most of the facility functions, but the bubble shield, perimeter laser and MARS guns require too much energy to support them all.
That sucks.
It pissed off Abalone for sure. After all the trouble they went through reprogramming the robots, now the island's big guns weren't doing anything to help us. The tank rounds flying over the gate had clearly enough space, and the slaver ponies started grappling up the sides to reach the top of the wall. The sprite bots were reconnaissance droids, meant for monitoring battlefields, so they easily started flying over the wall.
What a situation. It's almost like a battle in the Great War. Hundreds of ponies and machines fighting each other, with one side defending a stronghold.
Everything felt like it was happening so fast. Aunt Abalone showed up to check on us as the sentinel droids retreated back to the first line of the building. If we couldn't keep them from coming over the wall, we could at least draw a line in the sand so that they wouldn't get any deeper into the island. Abalone climbed onto the nearest MARS gun, the one called Phobos, that stood between the east gate and the tower building. From there, she used her anti-material rifle to shoot anything coming up the main road. One of the slavers galloped forward in thick metal armor, which was no match for one of the high-density 50-caliber bullets. The rounds passed through the mare's helmet, splitting it in two down the middle. By the time each half hit the ground, the head was gone. My dad and I were on the ground next to the MARS gun, holding the line. We were backed up by only a few sentinel droids that were standing in front of us. It was a tactical decision. All of the East Corp fighting robots, including the sprite bots, have the same subroutine built into their combat programming. Unless told otherwise, they were always firing at the most threatening target first. In this case, the sentinel droids were much bigger threat than we were, so they attracted the laser fire while we shot at the slavers.
Well, it sounds like you were holding your own pretty well.
We were fighting back, but we definitely weren't holding our own. Every minute passed, another dozen sprite bots came over the wall. There were simply too many of them.
They were cutting down our sentinel droids little by little. At this point, it was war of attrition, and we would run out of robots before they did. The only backup plan we had was the war balloon sitting in Sky Dock Number 3. The RES New Horizon had gotten fixed up years ago, but we had never flown it because it would have become a great beacon showing our location for miles. But even then, the most we could fit on the airship was maybe 150 ponies, and that was accounting for the flizzing cults.
Wait a second. It's a war balloon, though. Couldn't you just use it to take out the tank or some of the forces on the bridge?
Most of them would have been inside the island by the time we got the balloon airborne. But even then, we wouldn't have anything to attack them with. All the weapons on the balloons were removed. The bombs, the guns, the lasers, everything was gone. And we never knew where they went. If they were still on the island, there was only one place left they could be. But since we couldn't get in there, the balloon had always been our emergency escape plan. It was prepared for a long-term escape voyage with the supplies to match. And every second passed with every one of our friends that got killed. It was soon looking to be our only option.
But something tells me it was an option none of you wanted to take. Your mom, your dad, your aunt had all been driven from their homes so many times. They had basically spent their entire lives on the run. If Mare Island wasn't safe, no place was safe.
That is how they felt. I could see it in both of their eyes. They never intended to leave on the war balloon. They would either live on the island or die on the island. But the last thing I wanted was to see either of them die. I didn't want to get shoved onto the balloon to watch my dad and my aunt get murdered by robots from a distance. So that's when I made a decision. As soon as my dad was distracted, giving covering fire for abalone, I ran off with Ultramarine and Hyacinth, another sentinel droid. With everything going on around us and pressure coming on from all sides, I was hit with a sudden revelation. We entered the tower from the east, which turned out to be the Sentinel Droid production facility. But the tower was composed of three separate warehouses on the bottom level. So instead of jumping in where the killer robots are made, we could go through one of the other sections. I galloped around the north side of the building and approached the side of the tower that faced the west gate, the side where the bridge had been destroyed during the Great War. I typed in the executive level password and went inside. This section of the tower confirmed one of our past theories. Around the island, we had access to the smaller shops that built laser rifles and body armor. But all of that, very important items, were made right inside of the main tower building. One of those sections made the sentinel droids. This section made the large weapons and warheads. Right next to the door were three fully built laser batteries, like the ones on the walls. Other areas had stacks of bombs and ordnance ready to be shipped off to the front lines. The last area we passed contained a large set of guns and bombs that looked like they had been taken off the war balloon.
Well, that answers that question. But what about guards? Did you run into any other sentinel droids?
Several worker bee construction robots were standing around, but so far we hadn't seen any military ones. Ultramarine and Hyacinth galloped beside me as we reached the office area to the side of the building. I pushed the skeleton out the chair and started working. It didn't take long to catch up where I had gotten before. I had made so much progress through the code, I had to finish what I started, no matter what. In my mind, I thought that if I couldn't get through, abalone and my dad were as good as dead. As I was typing, though, I heard a sentinel droid approach Ultramarine and Hyacinth, who were both guarding the door to the office. It started to ask him to move, but my robots won't budge.
since they weren't obeying, it immediately assumed that they had been compromised and began attacking. It was a very interesting fight, though. They were surrounded on all sides by explosives, the kind of explosives that were meant to destroy huge chunks of the world. So the tower sentinel droids whipped its tail around, which extended to a long snake-like appendage. The end of the tail had a sharp electrified tip. The robot started flinging it towards them, trying to pierce through their armor and destroy their circuitry from within. But Hyant and Ultramarine could do the same thing with their tails. By working together, they were able to stab their way into the robot's face and neck, electrifying the inside until it fell over, smoking.
Damn, is there anything they can't do?
What they can't do is last much longer if they're outnumbered. I could see the other robots approaching us from the far side of the building. While distracted by that, my gauntlet started beeping. It was my dad trying to contact me. I silenced the beeping so I could get back to work. I refocused myself, clicking away as fast as I could. It wasn't long until more robots were right on top of us. Ultramarine and Hyacinth were just about to strike when the last digit in my description fell into place. With a reassuring ping, the terminal greeted me with the executive and took me to the control screen. My heart almost dropped. I couldn't believe what was happening.
Of course you'd be happy. You had finally done it. You had cracked the executive encryption.
Without even thinking, I went into security settings and disabled the code black lockdown. All at once, the dim emergency light switched off, while the bright warehouse light started powering up. The sentinel droids outside the door retracted their tails and stopped attacking us. I hooked up my gauntlet to the terminal and updated my identification profile to executive, just in case. When I galloped back out, one of the sentinel droids greeted me. After blinking at my gauntlet, it said,
"Welcome to Building 1, the Mayor's Island Tower. How can I help you, Executive Amberhorn?"
"I need to restart the reactors immediately. What's the fastest route?"
"You can use the elevator on the south side of the middle section. The reactors can be restarted in the system command center on basement level 12.
"Thanks," I answered. As I ran, I sent a message out to every gauntlet telling them the building was safe. I told them to retreat there if they needed and start getting the sentinel droids reprogrammed. Not surprisingly, my dad tried calling me again.
"And you didn't answer?"
"I couldn't answer. I wasn't going to stop halfway. I still had a job to do. And until I could restart the reactors, we were all at risk." I hoped impatiently, waiting for the elevator to finally arrive. But once it did, Hyacinth, Ultramarine, and I rode the car down into the heart of Mare's Island. A terminal screen to one side showed us the name of each floor that we were passing. At the bottom, it showed the levels that concerned me. Basement 10, Alternate Control Center. Basement 11, Geothermal Hydromatic Reserve Power Complex. Basement 12, System Command Center. Basement 13, Reactor Complex. As we passed each floor, we heard the sound of the blast doors opening and closing. Every level was able to seal off from the others. If they had the right equipment, they could each be their own stable. But more realistically, they were made to protect the tower in case something happened above or below. If the Bellfire bomb hit the tower, the lower levels would still have been safe. The engineers and scientists would have survived and could surface at a later point. That is, if they weren't all murdered by the sentinel droids meant to protect them.
Yeah, that right there was the weak link in their defensive systems.
In the same kind of way, the blastoids protected them if something went wrong with the reactors. If the reactors were sabotaged,
Even if they went critical, the explosion would have been contained underneath the titanium and bedrock. The whole level was designed with a failsafe. Should the reactors blow up, there were pressure release vents which would fail first until they reached the bottom of the river. The river water would then pour down those pressure vents and flood the reactors to minimize any possible explosion. Although the water could get contaminated, everyone on the top of the island would be safe and they could filter clean water anyway. Then the facility would keep running from the alternative power several layers above the reactor. But as far as I knew, nothing had gone wrong with the reactors. They simply overheated and shut down, as they were supposed to do. All I had to do was restart them and get the big guns working again. Once the door opened, we galloped through the lobby, which had a smaller hallway and offices to each side. On the other side of that lobby were the large metal doors of the system command center. I walked up to the terminal and put my executive password. I thought things had finally worked out. I thought it was finally almost over, but there was one last obstacle in my way. When the doors opened, two large sentinel droids marched out from each side. Unlike Ultramarine and the others, these were not mare-sized robots at all. Each of the giant, mechanized monsters resembled a workhorse. These sentinel droids could easily be power-armored for any buck I've ever met. The only other noticeable difference, besides their large masculine appearance, were the mounted weapons that stretched out on each shoulder. One of the weapons looked like a shotgun, and the other looked like a sniper rifle. However, as intimidating as they looked, they also looked old-fashioned, like they were earlier model sentinoids. The Series 4 models, like Ultramarine, have a very sleek, tightly fitting joints. They can move very quietly for what they are. These two stallions were making loud sounds every time they stepped. The hydraulics in the legs were very robust, with very little effort put into making them quiet.
So it sounds like they were a better match for your aunt's description of them as clockwork killing machines.
Without a doubt. I was nervous just at the sight of them because they were so much to take in. One of the robot's eyes blinked and my gauntlet answered in response. But then, deep synthesized voice came through the robot.
Binary identification required. Performing retinal scan.
Before I even processed what it was saying, I saw a quick flash in one of my eyes and had to blink to make the stars go away.
Retinal scan not found. Intruder alert.
I thought you had lifted the code black lockdown.
I had lifted it for every other part of the facility, but this was the source. The siren that had been sounding for almost 200 years. Once I had gained access to the computers here, it would be all over. But then...
Lethal force authorized.
The robot started shooting at Ultramarine and Hyson. Just like all the others, they attacked the bigger threat first. I had to somersault to get out of the way of the shotgun fires. I could hear a few stray pellets bouncing off my combat armor. But the rounds weren't doing too much damage to my sentinel droids. Their armor was newer and stronger. Both Hyson and Ultramarine extended their wings and firing their lasers from each side. The wing lasers were automatic, firing a succession of small bolts like machine guns, and then once every second a powerful laser beam would fire from their visor. They were starting to melt through the robot stallion's armor while I gave suppressing fire from an alcove by one of the officers. Both of the robots were still blocking my path into the system command center, so I couldn't get past them. But then things changed very quickly. One of the stallions lined up the sniper rifle and fired a round straight into Hythen's visor. In an instant, she fell over,
her head almost destroyed. It must have been an anti-material rifle similar to Aunt Abalone's sniper rifle. While the Sentinel droid armor was very strong, the visor was the weak spot because of how many purposes it served.
It wasn't just a thick piece of metal alloy, it was a weapon, a terminal screen, a scanner, a camera. There were too many sensitive electronics right up next to the glass.
No matter how tough they made it, the glass would shatter before the armor would give. So the armor-piercing round shot right through the glass and bounced around inside her head, destroying nearly all of the components.
Well, at least that explains why these out-of-date robots were still being used.
Luckily, Ultramarine was able to take the opportunity to fire a concentrated shot through a separation in the armor below his chin. A flash of fire erupted as the circuitries melted into one another, and the stallion was decapitated from the inside. She kept firing at the other stallion and also extended the sharp scorpion-like weapon from her tail.
She shoved the spiked point into one of the weakened armor plates, but before she could electrocute the robot, she was distracted momentarily by a sound. Both she and I turned when we heard a ping come from the elevator. The second elevator opened, revealing my dad and three other books that had come with him.
In that moment, the robot angled the anti-material weapon and shot her Ultramarine's ear. Because of the raised angle that he had fired, the bullet passed through the black metal mesh of the listening device, bounced around inside her armored skull. The bullet destroyed everything inside, and her visor shattered outward from the momentum. When my dad took in what happened, he shouted at me.
Amber.
I shouted back at him as I continued shooting at the robot. I think he's the last one. We just have to stop him and get inside.
The robot turned towards my dad and the three other stallions. As a group, they were the larger threat.
Go, he said. We'll take care of him.
The robot marched past my position as my dad and the others took cover. When it was clear enough, I galloped into the system command center.
It might be lucky you never answered his call. He showed up at just the right moment.
Once I was inside, I found myself surrounded on all sides by servers and speakers. Each of the other buildings only had one or two of the big server towers each, but here there were easily 100 that filled up the space. The 12 desks in the middle had a scattered assortment of dead bodies around them. Even all the way down here, 100 feet below the surface, buried under metal and earth, something went wrong. Something very important failed, and because of that, every pony died.
I wish I could say that was rare, but it seems like most stories I hear involve an unfortunate number of deaths.
The only thing that matters in those cases are that those deaths actually mean something. That they brought about something greater good. There was one computer terminal on the far wall. It was bigger and significantly more important than the others. The three large monitors wrapped around the chair of the horseshoe-shaped desk. Above the terminal was a massive display screen that everyone in the room could see. Along the side of the screen, white text was flashing inside of black boxes. All four show the same warning, code black lockdown. I walked up to that master terminal. The skeleton in the chair was a small stallion. He had a business suit on, but the coat was removed and draped over the chair. The white sleeves had been rolled up in a frayed style fashion, and one of the buttons on the vest was undone. His white shirt was soaked in dried blood. One of the anti-material rounds had passed through his heart. The Sentinel droid's aim was careful enough that the bullet missed the important computer equipment. I set the bones aside and gained access to the terminal. It only took a few minutes to get the system to accept my executive level clearance. Once I did,
It gave me a dignified greeting. Welcome, Chief Engineer Amberhorn.
I'd say it's a title well earned.
It definitely is.
The first thing I did was disable the code black lockdown. That should keep the Sentinels from being a threat to us anymore. Then I restarted the reactor. I felt a gentle vibration beneath my hooves as the machinery below came to life. It would take a minute to charge up to full capacity, so I looked through the other things on the system. The thing that stunned me the most was seeing that Mare's Island wasn't unique. At least it wasn't the only East Court facility. There was a network map with several other site names listed. However, I couldn't access any of them because someone had separated Mare's Island from that global network. There was a warning saying physical failsafe had been activated. Somewhere deep underground, the data line connecting Mare's Island to the outside world had been literally destroyed.
It kind of sounds like what your parents had done with all the buildings on the surface. Separate them from the main network so you could take control.
But whoever tried to take control of Mare's Island must have made a mistake, because there was no one left alive. Not even way down there at the bottom of the tower. I quickly put that aside when I was notified that the reactors were up and running. I pulled up the defense system and activated all the weapons. Finally, after 20 years, the Sentinels had full control of Mare's Island. I set the new targeting perimeters and watched the action unfold from the large monitor screen. On top of the perimeter walls, all the laser batteries started coming to life. Each of them jolted as they moved for the first time in 2 centuries. A cloud of dust fell off them as they swiveled around and found targets. The slavers and sprite bots had pushed their way further into the island, so halt of the laser batteries spun inwards aiming down. In a second, they all started firing powerful blue rays of light. With a single hit, the magical energy bolts turned the slavers to ash. The sprite bots they shot exploded into a million pieces. It wasn't long until all the enemies inside the wall were dead. The laser batteries had an effective range of several miles, so they were quickly dispatching the ponies on the bridge and along the shore. Sitting parked along the River Six, all 4 of the buses they brought were melting away from the laser's heat. When the heat finally reached their spark batteries, each of the buses exploded in a flash of orange light. This left only one target remaining. After seeing the perimeter lasers come to life, Lockjaw had quickly retreated across the bridge, like the little coward he was. The tank was rolling so fast that he didn't stop for anyone. He probably killed at least 6 of his slavers by driving over them. The tank's armor was very thick, and the lasers weren't melting it fast enough. But that didn't matter, because after driving all this way, I thought he deserved a little more of a bang for his buck. The MARS guns came to life as Antabalone was perching on top of it. The noise of the barrel spun slowly around finding its new target. Fast Whip Lockjaw, whatever he called himself, was the purest incarnation of evil. He was a curse that had literally plagued my family for generations. He whipped my grandfather to death and shot my grandmother in the head. He enslaved my dad as just a cult and traumatized him throughout his entire childhood. He enslaved my mum and my aunt Abalone. He had threatened the families of other slaves and forced one of them to stab my mum. But after all this time, all these years, he could not leave us alone. We had to flee to the far corners of the wasteland. We just wanted to be left alone. We just wanted to live our lives in peace. But he wouldn't let us. And now, he had stolen our sprite bots and used them to murder another 100 of our people.
brave sentinels who had fought to their dying breath to protect our little home, the small pieces of this world that we call our own. The barrel of the MARS gun raised its elevation and pointed to the sky. With a mighty blast, the weapon fired. The force of the warhead was so great that it punched a hole in the cloud barrier above us. An orange ray from the setting sun shone through the hole, shining down on Ambelo and the tower next to her. Lockjaw's tank had just reached the top of the hill when a second hole was punched through the sky and it rained down on top of him. The warhead exploded into a bright green mushroom cloud that rose over the horizon. It rose so high that it could be seen for miles across the five highway wasteland. It was a symbol to everyone that we are no longer hiding in fear. We are no longer the ones who had escaped away in the night. From now on, it will be the wasteland that stood in fear of us.
By the goddesses, that was a rousing speech. I'm starting to feel all patriotic.
I'm glad you liked them, because those were Abalone's words. Her words of victories to every pony on the surface.
Why just on the surface? Why wouldn't you be celebrating as well?
Amber?
Because I didn't deserve it. I walked out of the system command center as Abalone was still cheering. I saw the robotic stallion with Ultiman's tail wedged in his armor. He was laying on the side in the middle of his lobby. Half of its face was melted away and the circuitries in his head were still burning. Laying in front of it were the three stallions that had come with my dad. All were dead.
Oh, Amber.
There was so much blood on the floor that it connected all the bodies together in a thin pool. To the side of the pool, the blood streaked off in one direction by an alcove. I followed the trail. And I found my dad. He was barely breathing. Blood was coming from all over his body. He had been hit with the shotgun several times. Dad, I pleaded. Dad, please stay with me. I'm so sorry. Dad, please, please don't go. He was looking me right in the eye and tried to say something. I moved my ear down to his mouth, but no words came out. His breath was too shallow, so he slowly turned his head and kissed me on the horn, and then he closed his eyes and was gone. After all the fighting, after all the battling, the slavers, the monsters, the robots, the reason he died was because of me.
Amber, don't say that.
Because I had been so foolish. I had rushed in and taken things into my own hooves, and he's the one that had to die. Just like my mom is dead because of me. I should have never been born.
Amber, don't say that.
But I cost so many lives in the process. So many ponies died because of me. If it was my mum, she would have solved it. She would have planned it all out and none of this would have ever happened. They would have had the guns up long before Lockjaw showed up.
Amber, you don't know that. No one else could have thought the same way. None of them could have anticipated what happened, especially Silverstep. It is not your fault that your mother is dead. She faced horrible circumstances, but chose to risk everything because of how much she loved you, even without knowing you yet. She loved you because you were hers, and she wanted the best for you.
It wasn't long
long until Abalone showed up. She found us on the floor as I was clutching him in my arms. As soon as she saw what happened, her eyes went cold and grey. I knew what she was thinking. It didn't matter whether she said it or not. She held me there. She knew more than all of us how dangerous the robots were. But that still didn't stop me.
Amber.
I was only there for a few more days. After the funeral, I installed Aunt Abalone as the new chief engineer, the chief sentinel of Mare's Island. All the networks were reconnected and they had total control of everything. Once that was done, I slipped away during the night.
Wait, you just ran away? Without saying goodbye or anything? They must have been worried sick, sent out search parties and everything.
I left a note for Abalone. I knew she wouldn't have told the truth even if I talked to her face to face. Deep down, she knew that I caused one tragedy after another. They wouldn't have followed me anyway. They didn't need me anymore. I would just be a curse.
She probably misses you terribly. You are like her own daughter, the last of her family with your father gone. And now she's lost you too.
If I had stayed, I would have ended up killing her too, somehow. Or something else would have happened. I would get someone killed with the perimeter lasers or the MAR guns.
But with them, you saved them all. Over 400 ponies.
I ended up wandering east for a few months. I tried to get as far away as I could from Mare's Island, and eventually ended up on the coast. For those last weeks on the road, I heard you talking about Ten Pony Tower and how cold things had gotten since you were having power failures. I was cold too, and I knew I could help, which is how I ended up here in the first place.
And you've been a blessing to us. You probably saved me from frostbite that winter, and the station hasn't run this smoothly in years. The last thing you are is a curse.
You're our friend. We love and care about you. You've helped me through so much.
But I've run away for too long. I shouldn't be able to escape the past, which is why I wanted to tell the whole story. I deserve to live with my every mistake.
Amber.
I need to get back to the generator room. Thank you for letting me give my confession.
She doesn't have work tonight.
I know. So, citizens of post-apocalyptia, I'm not sure if this story will help anyone else out there, but honestly, more than anything, I'm hoping it can help Amber. I don't know how far my voice carries across the vast, empty wasteland anymore, but if anyone from Mare Island is listening, if Abalone is listening, then I want to let you know that Amberhorn is here at Ten Pony Tower in New York. She is alive and safe, but she is broken. She disappeared because she was unfortunately driven by guilt, and even though that has clouded her, she only made those decisions because she loved you. If you care about her as much as Amage and I do, please contact me somehow. Because this story can't end like this.
Every story must come to an end. I wish I could tell you more. We've had
had our sadness and we've had our fun. Something we can't ignore. And though we may fly to the east and the west, and distance may keep us apart, we'll meet again where the hellhounds pray, and each one will do his part. Yes, we'll meet again where the steel rangers slay, and each one will do his part.